WikiLeaks has released more documents showing that Hillary Clinton was looking at going on Parkinson's medication. And another email has her saying, I quote, still don't feel great. And we've got more top scientists, more top neurologists going public saying Hillary clearly has serious neurological problems. The list is in the hundreds now. But that doesn't matter because she went on Jimmy Kimmel. And when she went on Jimmy Kimmel, ladies and gentlemen, he took her pulse. And then she opened a glass container of pickles. So now everything is okay. She has proven to the world she can basically do anything. And so I walked over to the cupboard this morning when I saw this clip on Infowars.com. And I got out a container of pickles. And I thought, you know, pickles, the reason they're hard to open is they're vacuum sealed. And you don't turn it like a regular top. It just pops and you're done. It doesn't go around, but she goes around it. Oh, to open it, it's so hard, like she's undoing a corkscrew or pulling a cork out of a wine bottle. And that's why I think Mark Dice shot a video last night pointing out that it's clearly fake, and I totally agree with him. But they're faking Google numbers. They're faking polls. We've got stacks of news admitting that today. Why wouldn't they fake this? Remember, the architect of Obamacare, Gruber, working for Obama, said, thank God the public doesn't pay attention. It's so stupid. So she strains as she turns around the pickles. No one opens pickles that way. In fact, let me just show you how you open pickles, okay? You don't go, oh, I got to go in a big circle. Or you never open pickles in 85 million years this way, okay? See that? Oh, and then it opens. No, no. You open it in one quick pop. Boop. It's done for TV viewers. Reminds me of Caddyshack when the character that Chevy Chase is playing has the hot blonde over to his house, and he doesn't have any fresh Perrier, so he pours two bottles together that are by a pizza box. I'm going to play this later, and puts the cap on top and walks over and goes, oh, boy, it just came right off. But now we have to scientifically show how this is staged. And by the way, Jimmy Fallon a few months ago, they've gone totally political. They always have been, but now it's so open, so brazen, so naked, so obvious, so over the top, so in your face, so arrogant towards their prey, you, the American people, that he's like, yeah, I hear TPP. I hear you support that. You down with TPP? They got this great jazz band playing. Obama's back there all cool. And he goes, yeah, you know me. It's like saying, you down with having a foreign corporate takeover of America and shutting down even more jobs and screwing everybody? Just like you double black unemployment? Yeah, you know me. But see, it's okay because it's fun. It's cool. It's all completely scripted. Just like taking her pulse. But it's all entertainment, isn't it? So it's okay. 100% scripted. You don't open a can of pickles by going in a big circle around it and opening it. They won't open that way. That's why women famously can't open them, because their daddy didn't teach them how to do it. A woman can open a can easy. You just go boom, pop. You don't go, totally fake, caught red-handed. Hillary Clinton has been caught in more fraud, more corruption, more deception, more racketeering with her cohorts, her willing accomplices. No, I don't mean the $35 million Russia paid her foundation to give the Russian government one-fifth of the U.S. uranium stockpile. No, I'm not talking about her transferring, when she was co-president in the mid-90s, the ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missile technology, from top to bottom, from guidance to boost to symmetry to re-entry to MIRV. No, I'm not talking about her arming Al-Qaeda and ISIS and turning them loose in the Middle East with Saudi Arabia and being the founder of ISIS as Donald Trump properly has called her. General Flynn has also basically said that, the former head of Defense Intelligence. No, I'm not talking about her going after our Second Amendment or helping get derivatives legalized in the mid-1990s with the usual suspects, people like Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan, individuals like Larry Summers, and then signing us on to all that debt that wasn't ours. No, I'm talking about what happened last night when she went on one of these mindless late-night entertainment shows, Jimmy Kimmel, and said that it's a conspiracy theory that she has any health problems. And then she basically had her pulse taken by Jimmy Kimmel, and then she opened a container of pickles. But she didn't really open the container of pickles, because we're going to prove at the bottom of the hour for TV viewers, we'll describe it for radio listeners, that that's not how you open a container of pickles. So I've got a whole bunch of containers of these. In an earlier segment, I already opened one and show people how you do it. But I'm going to show you the fraud blown up on video of her. And people say, oh, well, why does this matter? This is the type of thing that can capture the public's attention. They're like, oh, uranium to Russia. Oh, $100 million from Gulf states, you know, that execute gays and women for no reason. That's okay. But if she faked opening the glass container of pickles, folks, this is going to probably be a big deal for the general public. And I'm being serious. I'm not being facetious. But let's stop right there. We're going to have Roger Stone in studio today with us. Donald Trump is flying into Austin for a big rally in North Austin today. So who knows who'll be popping in or who knows who we'll be interviewing tonight on top of Stone to be in studio. I think his plane's getting in as we speak. And a lot more today. But before I go any further, before I even get into all these other big stacks of news, before I detail the latest jihad operations, I want to start with this stack, because this ties into everything. This is such an amazing stack. Reuters has a headline. And just this headline is an entire college course on deception. OSCE Rights Group requests 500 international observers to monitor U.S. presidential vote. And then it goes on, because they believe there's going to be fraud. But not by Hillary, but by Trump, with no evidence of that. She's the one that just stole it from Bernie Sanders. He stopped the Republicans from stealing it from him. Now, the real headline should be UN-EU directive, an organization to oversee U.S. elections. But see, they know that'll scare you and wake up people, because we've been warning of this forever. So they just say OSCE. That right there is the tactic. Then you read the Reuters article. The Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, that's the original group set up in the Marshall Plan that the UN was set up through. So this is the predecessor of that, to send 500 international observers to observe November U.S. presidential election, a tenfold increase from the number the group deployed in 2012. They knew Romney take a dive. And then it goes on with what they say. Now, I thought Donald Trump's a total kook for saying there's a lot of evidence of election fraud. We need to investigate it and watch it. But now the Justice Department is the group giving them the federal authority to do this. And they announced last week, Jay Johnson, that he's going to put fivefold the federal observers to make sure illegals and others can vote. That's really what's happening. So they're coming in to make sure voter fraud can take place, the Democrats' specialty. Isn't that just darling? So, contradictions within contradictions. The UN-EU, Organization of Economic Cooperative Development, that has this security treaty set up security cooperation in Europe. I mean, almost no one knows who all these groups and organizations are. I do. I've studied the globalists. So this is actually the original globalist organization that took over Europe after World War II to oversee our elections. This is beyond the UN. This is the group the Rockefellers and Rothschilds set up, and then they set up the UN after that. Global government. Now, let's continue. For 2 weeks, almost 3 weeks, we've been harping on the fact that there is no coverage in U.S. mainstream dinosaur, Decepticon, enemy, collaborator media, or what I should call discredited corporate media, 6% trust rate, according to the Associated Press and their own international study or national study. But strangely enough, in Europe, it's gotten coverage. In the German news and the French news and the Russian news, the Italian news, and now the Jerusalem Post gets it completely right when it says this. What have I been harping on day after day? Our world, Jerusalem Post, Soros campaign of global chaos. The first thing we see is the megalomaniacal nature of Soros' philanthropic project. No corner of the globe is unaffected by his efforts. No policy area is left untouched. And then it goes through the emails. How to overthrow the U.S. How to overthrow Israel. How to overthrow Europe. This is so, and we have him, diabolical. And some people, because they've been conditioned by the press, will say, oh my gosh, Israel's bad. Let's get Israel. Israel's a complex situation, and Israel's done some bad things, just like the U.S. has. But I'll tell you, I'll take Israel over George Soros any day, sweetheart. Israel's a diverse group. Soros is a Nazi collaborator, literal demon. But the point is, forget Israel. Forget the U.S. George Soros' emails are public for almost, what is it, 16 days. Thousands of them. How they're bringing in the Muslims to overthrow things. How they're destabilizing. It's all there. Arrest him. And even the Jerusalem Post comes out. If I have time later in the third hour, I'm going to read this whole article. But I've got hundreds, so I've got to move. UN to run our elections with just department power and under strong cities, I'm getting chills, to oversee our police departments. That's Loretta Lynch saying that, not me. We are so conquered. But if we admit we've been taken over, it will implode. It's illegitimate. What do they call in the North American Union documents of 2008 from Banff, Canada, when Judicial Watch sued and got them? What do they call it? They called it North American Integration and Global Governance by Stealth. What does stealth need to be stealth? If it's not stealth, it crashes and burns. Oh, we're going to beat these people. And by the way, it's not the Russians hacking Soros. I can tell you that. I've confirmed from high-level sources that it's U.S. agencies. Absolutely. Wake up. Save the country. We can defeat these people bloodlessly by exposing their crimes. Let's keep hitting them and hitting them hard. I salute the folks inside the government doing this. Hit them and hit them hard. Hit all of them. But notice the whole world's hitting Soros. Everybody knows who the enemy is. Worldwide concern over too many immigrants study shows. Yahoo News. But that's okay. Paris tourism chief demands rescue plan as attacks scare off visitors. And they basically lost half their tourism last year. But don't worry. Daily Mail has the quote and there's a video. But it's in Parlez-vous Français. Borders are the worst invention ever, close quote. EU chief Jean-Claude Juncker. Look into the Juncker family, folks. Widens rift with European leaders as he calls for open borders. That's like saying doors on your house are the worst invention ever, or privacy is the worst invention ever, or having a safe is the worst invention ever. If we didn't have borders, Genghis Khan would rule the world today, or his offspring would, or Hitler. I mean, what are they talking about? A bad guy takes over one country, other countries can organize against it. But under a global government, you can't do that. You're under one system. So the people are like, we're panicking. They're murdering us. 5 million have poured in. They're killing people. They're burning vehicles. They're robbing. They're raping. And he's just like, we're getting rid of it. EU boss sparks border outrage. Juncker slammed over beyond parody. Checkpoint madness. But don't worry. Sarkozy announces a bid for 2017. He's the guy that helped get rid of their borders. 8 Facebook users indicted for mocking. Gotta love that. But before I get into all this other news, massive censorship in Europe against anybody criticizing this. This is how they're conquering the planet. And the head of the UN Borders and Migrants Council is actually the founder of the EU. And he is openly admitting it is to bring down the West. And then we've got the clip we played yesterday of Vice President Biden saying, yes, white people are bad. We've got to get rid of them. I mean, this is crazy. Donald Trump's going to be speaking tonight, 7 o'clock at the Travis County Expo Center in North Austin. The venue holds, I think, about 20,000 people. And we're going to have our crew inside. We're going to have our crew outside. The communists are going to be up there. I'm told the same ones that came out and tried to physically attack us. It was like retarded zombies, you know, you see in movies. They weren't very effective. So we're all going to be out there this evening. And if Trump isn't on the show today, he'll be on the show Friday. But I'm just going to leave it at that. Roger Stone's plane is delayed. Just took off from Dallas, where he was flying in from Florida. And so he should be here by the middle of the broadcast in about an hour for the balance of the transmission today. Okay, where to start? Where to begin getting into all of this news that I haven't covered yet, which is the majority of it? You have to understand, when I just covered Reuters with the corporation and organization that founded the UN saying it's going to oversee our elections, that is so huge. And they're doing it at tenfold what they did in 2012. So see, this is an escalation. And I can play the clips of Loretta Lynch in the press conference 6 months ago saying, under strong cities, we will follow the UN, UNESCO treaties, which we haven't ratified, on policing, on small arms, all of it. And they will tell the review boards and recommend to the Justice Department what to do in your town. She said, the UN will give us our orders. Remember Obama a few years ago in Syria? He said, I'm going to act alone outside of Congress. I have the authority of the United Nations. Even though he didn't have the authority. Then he said, well, now, because the UN wouldn't even go along with it because Russia vetoed it, he went further and he said, okay, I have the authority of NATO. That is a consortium of North Atlantic countries. The U.S. comprising half its force and funding. This is open world government, people. Where our politicians get bought off, they sign us over to the TPP, the UN, the World Trade Organization, the IMF, the World Bank, all run by the same 100 or so people. You look at who runs the CFR, who runs the IMF, who runs the World Bank, who runs the International Bank of Settlements, who runs the OECD, who runs the OSCE. It's 100 people or less. And, of course, who is one of the masters that would always organize all those people? Henry Kissinger. And it's why Hillary Clinton's gotten up in speeches. And it's why General Jones, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs, and then former National Security Council head, have gone on TV and in print journals and said, I get my orders from Henry Kissinger and the Council on Foreign Relations every day. Those are quotes by both of them to rub your nose in. And remember when Obama violated Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution and worked at the United Nations as the Secretary General for a time? And then when he sat in and chaired the Security Council for one rotation? Less than a year, but it was almost a year. You can go into all the details of it. This is open world government in your face. They are practicing it. They are exercising it. They are engaging in it in front of you. And again, it's not like they're bringing in some Star Trek lovey-dove UN world government thing, kumbaya. It's to carry out deindustrialization. It's to carry out austerity. It's to carry out the eugenics endgame. World government's a means to an end. Now, I'm going to stop there. Coming up, because it's illustrative of their fraud, we're going to prove that Hillary Clinton didn't really open that container of pickles on Jimmy Kimmel. And then we're going to show some of the other political stunts that late-night TV's involved in for this crime cartel. Then I'm going to get into forced inoculations in the United States, now official. We're going to get into the fact they're not letting any Christian refugees into the U.S. We're going to get into the latest on Hillary's health. That ties into all this. We're going to get into the latest on the Clinton Foundation, the economy, and a lot more. I'm Alex Jones. This is a very important broadcast. Everybody can listen to Infowars.com/show or see the video feed or on stations across the country. Roger Stone's going to be in studio later. We're going to have live coverage tonight, starting at 7 o'clock Central and going for hours, of Trump coming to Austin, Texas. And we'll have the communists outside, whatever they're up to. We'll also have crew inside and, of course, some surprises as well. Coming up this evening, 7 o'clock Central, many of our radio affiliates now pick up TV show. I never thought of that. I was doing a TV show to get on television, and I do a radio show that's / TV for the internet that's 3 hours long and live. Well, now 4 hours that you're watching and listening to right now. But then I started doing the nightly news a few years ago, 4 years ago, and stations started calling and saying, hey, that's really good radio, too. We want to pick that up. So I know that more than 50 of our affiliates actually are picking up the hour-long nightly news. So really exciting. And a lot of them take our live coverage of debates. They take our election coverage. It's really crazy. I'm telling you, if we went 20 hours a day live, it would change the world. The problem is I don't have the capital, the crew yet. But more and more, I am thinking about doing something like that just because there's so much news, so much analysis, so much happening. I can get a crew of maybe, I don't know, 10 more crew members and 10 more on-air hosts and just have each person do an hour or so a day of live analysis and just coverage. It's teleprompter free, and it would get picked up everywhere. And I think that's really where we should just go. We're obviously going to get into the latest on the economy, the latest on medical tyranny here in the United States as the system moves for forced inoculations. The administration saying that for every 1,000 Muslims they bring in as refugees, they might bring in a couple Christians. That trend is continuing as well. But the first thing I want to do is debunk Hillary Clinton on her claim that it's a conspiracy theory and that it's illegitimate to come out and question her health. The Democratic Party made a really big deal out of John McCain's health in 2008. And quite frankly, I think that that was probably legitimate. John McCain has some serious health problems and was hiding them. But just like they had some legitimate criticisms of Bush's lackluster response to Katrina, when Obama didn't even show up for 6 days and Hillary never showed up, that's a big deal, especially when they're criticizing Donald Trump. So there's a double standard. And I'm about to prove that she didn't open that container of pickles on Jimmy Kimmel Live last night. But first, let's go to Google's own admissions. This story's on Infowars.com. Just to illustrate the fraud that happens on a daily basis. Google hides Clinton body count search suggestions. They admit they've done things like delist Trump during key parts of the election cycle as a presidential candidate, period. It goes on and on and on. So that's the latest article today. Don't want people to investigate the deaths, the mysterious deaths. And the Democrats have hired a big PR agent to deal with this, and they're interfacing with Google. Another report. Trump defeats Hillary in a poll. Monmouth amends it to give Hillary the victory. Oh, they said, oh, well, that can't be right. Let's go back and fix this. Poll weighed 29 Republicans to 33 Democrats to let Hillary win. Now let's give it to Monmouth. They didn't have 15% more Democrats than Republicans like Reuters and others have done, but simply astounding. Now, since you saw those two little pieces of fraud, don't forget that we've seen Jimmy Fallon come out and push the Trans-Pacific Partnership as if it's trendy and cool with Obama. They're trying to use entertainment to push things that wouldn't be palatable in a real news format of even half-educated or informed people. So last night we got treated to her going on the program. And we're going to play the full clip here in a moment. And Jimmy Kimmel reaches over and takes her pulse and then makes a joke about it. And she talks about the wacky, kooky way she's being attacked. She doesn't have any health issues. Hoping that the audience isn't aware of the fact that they've had dozens and dozens of top brain surgeons, neurologists, you name it, some of which are even Democrats, go on TV and say she shows signs of neurological impairment. They don't talk about the fact that the new WikiLeaks email has come out with Hillary looking to take Parkinson's medication and talking about how she couldn't get out of bed. This is in her emails. So they are engaged in a cover-up. We know that back in 2012, 2013, she spent basically a year in a hospital that specializes in brain surgery and brain tumors and neurological problems. And they admit she had surgeries for blood clots, but she's not released those medical records. Now, that said, all of that laid out here, and doctors coming out every day, and new videos of her stumbling and falling down and not being able to stand up and acting disoriented, looking like she's having many seizures. And our Secret Service leaked intel that she indeed has some serious neurological disorders, had to have her vehicles fitted with special systems that lower down to the ground so she can be basically lifted into the car. Despite all of that, they put her on an entertainment show like Jimmy Kimmel, and he takes her pulse, and then he opens, or she supposedly opens, a can of pickles. Now, I noticed this right away, and we blew the video up. There's no pop when she opens it, and she acts like she has to turn it all the way around like she's opening a can of peanut butter. But anyone who's opened a sealed can of pickled vegetables, whether it be tomatoes, whether it be garlic, whether it be olives, whether it be pickled fruit, knows there is a pop. You don't turn around it. You can't open a can of pickles that way. You pressure down and pop it open and then unscrew it. There's no pop. She acts like it pops at the end. This is completely and totally fake and scripted and all part of entertainment. So let's play the unedited clip to analyze it.
Speaking of rumors that have gotten started, there's now the new one is that you are unhealthy, that you had a concussion, that Rudy Giuliani was on Fox News yesterday and today, and he's saying you seem to be sick, you look tired, et cetera, et cetera. Mm. Are you in good health?
Well, this has become one of their themes. Here, you take my pulse while I'm talking to you.
Okay.
Make sure I'm alive.
Oh my God, there's nothing there.
There's nothing there. What should I say? Back in October, the National Enquirer said I would be dead in 6 months.
Oh, wow. Oh, boy.
So with every breath I take, I feel like it's a...
You have a new lease on life.
Yeah, a new lease on life. I don't know why they are saying this. I think on the one hand, it's part of the wacky strategy.
Uh-huh.
Just say all these crazy things and maybe you can get some people to believe you. On the other hand, it just absolutely makes no sense. And I don't go around questioning Donald Trump's health. I mean, as far as I can tell, he's as healthy as a horse.
Well, his doctor said he had the best health medical examination he's ever seen in a human being.
Yeah, I saw that.
Can you open this jar of pickles? This has not been tampered with.
All right. We got a full screen. Watch this. That is totally fake. And notice she's wearing a lav mic. You would hear the pop of the can. Now, before I demonstrate this for folks, I'll describe this for radio listeners. Let's do it in slow-mo. Let's go ahead and show this in slow motion. No, first let's show it blown up, and then we'll show it in slow motion. Here it is. Total acting. And then she just lifts it off the top. That's not how you open a can of pickles. Now, we did some humor here. This reminded me of when the Ty Webb character in Caddyshack, 1980 classic, has the hot blonde over at his house, and he's got a half-eaten pizza out and two Perriers. He pours them together and tries to put the cap back on. I've actually done that myself years ago. Just kind of reenacting it in college, but I actually did do it. And comes over and acts like he's opening it, and it's just as fake as when Hillary does it. Here it is.
Right. Ooh. Yeah.
Okay, now we've got it blown up one more time. Seriously, you're watching this. This is not how you open a can. Okay? And I've got four different containers here. I've already opened one earlier as a test just to make sure my memory was serving me correct. I probably opened 300 of these in my life or more. Okay, and I've got different brands here. It's all the same. You pop them open. You pop them open. That's why if your hands are greasy, it's hard to do, or sweaty. You pop them. You don't turn them like it's peanut butter or jelly or something, or like you're opening up, a can of fertilizer or whatever. It's popped. It's vacuum sealed. It's vacuum sealed. Okay, boom. See that? Pop. Now dripping all over the mouse pad here. Excuse me. Don't try this at home, ladies and gentlemen. Now continuing, here is a larger container of Vlasic. And again, now my hands are wet, just what I was talking about. This is not product placement. Again, you will notice, you don't open it going like this and then it pops off. You open it by pressuring down and popping. Look at that, I can't even really get it open because my hands are wet. So that's how strong I am. But Hillary Clinton, that's God. Look at that. I am so weak. Also hurt my hand last week. I am so weak. I can't even open this. This is real. This is really happening. Where's Hillary Clinton when you need her? I mean, I don't want to look like I'm not manly here. Sometimes you got to bang this up of a table. I guess we got one that was really tough. I can't. This might happen one out of 50. I can't even open this, but Hillary Clinton can. I mean, this is the level of bull we're dealing with here. Okay? See it. There we go. So you have to pop it, ladies and gentlemen. You have to pop it. My hands were wet. Really on there, though. Let me try this one. This is a smaller Vlasic. Now the whole office can enjoy some pickles today. Continuing. I almost broke my hand a few weeks ago. Remember the whole trading punches with Weldon Henson, which I will not be doing again. I am not 20 years old anymore. I'm going to show you again. Can we zoom in on this to show people what Hillary did? She claims she went around, and then it just comes right off like that. But she does this whole fake like she's straining. In fact, let me copy Hillary Clinton real quick. Give me a wide shot. I'm making a Bernie Sanders sound. Going in a big circle. And then it comes off. They don't come off like that. They come off like pressure. Just open it. That's how they come off. Dripping more of this now. Since when do you open these? They drip everywhere. I guess these are filled to the brim. So there you go. I worked up a sweat there. And we can now take that video, edit it down for brevity, and put it out for folks, but leave the part in when I couldn't open it. This is just classic. This is so ridiculous. One more time with the Caddyshack clip as well, because, I mean, you can't watch it only once. Let's show Hillary with the staged opening of the can of pickles. Here it is.
Right. Ooh.
Oh, by the way, I was going to illustrate that too. We have a can opener. Look, all you have to be president now is to be able to open a container of water or be able to open a container of pickles. So basically, this is what it looks like when you really open up a bottle of water that's carbonated. Okay? Now, I just did that. That's what it looks like. Now, when it's fake, I would put this back on just like that. Okay? I'm Ty Webb from Caddyshack. Reenacting Caddyshack is key. And then I'm trying to act cool to the hot blonde. I'm like, oh, baby, I got you a little fresh drink here. Oh, whoa, whoa. Oh, my gosh. I can't reenact that. I put it back. I'm better than Ty. Oh, look at that. Here, I'll have to reenact it with this one. Since I already ruined that time. This is live teleprompter free, ladies and gentlemen. This is not fake, okay? You know, we're actually trying to illustrate how it's fake, and it's even hard to do. Okay? There we go. And did too good a job here. Let me just... There you go. Hello, my darling. How are you doing? Would you like a fresh drink? Oh, whoa, there you go. So, I guarantee our ratings are skyrocketing right now. you know, just do the right thing, though. Can we please play the entire unedited Caddyshack clip when he's in there? We don't have it. Now, like in Saudi Arabia, they're arresting people that disagree with the government, calling it sorcery, and it's a death penalty, which I don't normally agree with. But I don't think if you don't have the full Caddyshack clip ready, that is the death penalty. We do have it? Okay, then you're reprieved. Here it is.
Here's an uncashed check for $70,000.
Keep it.
There's a bunch of them. And a summons.
Yours.
Pretty pathetic, Ty.
Pathetic? Maybe you, Lacey. For me, there's a subtle perfection in everything I do. I have my own standards, my own way.
My uncle says you got a screw loose.
Oh, yeah? Your uncle molests collies. You're rather,
What?
Attractive for a beautiful girl with a great body. Well, hey!
That's Hillary.
Yeah.
Oh, that's enough. Hillary is so incredibly powerful that she probably can just look at a can of Perrier. We went to the grocery store this morning. They didn't have it for some reason because it was sold out, so we got Topo Chico. Up there, check cashes. No, I'm serious. This is not product placement. And it just illustrates we have all this incredibly serious news going on. We have Hillary caught in all these frauds. The missile secrets to China, you know, 17, 18 years ago. The uranium deals 5 years ago to Russia that nobody else could deal, you know, could get for $35 million. All the corruption, all the lies, the emails, the administration she was part of persecuting all these innocent people. But it's okay because they go on these TV shows and act popular and cool and funny and make jokes about people that question known liars. Oh, and we're going to edit that whole train wreck that you just saw or heard 10 minutes ago together into a shorter piece to illustrate how we caught her lying, how there's no pop when you open up the container of pickles. And just add this little point onto that. We should play, just because we mentioned it, the Down with TPP clip. Because that really makes me sicker than this. Here's the TPP handing over our national sovereignty to shadowy corporate global groups. Secretly negotiated. The public couldn't even see it. It was already basically passed and agreed upon globally. And they just put Obama up there with some jazz blues singers. And he says he's down with TPP like, you know, one of those rap songs. So it's cute and funny. This is making becoming slaves to global government funny, and it's not funny. Here's that clip.
Now, hold on there, Fred Dispenser. Are you saying you're down with TPP?
Yeah, you know me.
So it's cool, it's fun, it's cute. The lighting's perfect. It's all scripted. They're great actors, and they just screwed that audience hardcore. President, are you down with having a secretive global government group leverage out what jobs we've got left and exploit people with slave labor? The TPP actually doesn't outlaw slavery and actually makes it legal again. Are you for that? Yes, I'm down with that. All right. It's a very, very serious subject. And I've gone over it now with a little bit of humor here. Maybe a little funnier if you're actually watching on television. But for radio listeners, obviously, the next few hours we'll have that clip of a live transmission posted up on Infowars.com. But they admit these exchanges are scripted. So it's a fact. Or you can believe lying, crooked Hillary. But getting back to some of the latest news that she says is a conspiracy theory, top doctor concerns over Hillary's health, not a conspiracy theory. Rutgers University professor of medicine says Clinton should be assessed by an impartial panel of physicians. What did Dr. Pachinik say on the show last week? Just that. Here's a new article up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com that everybody needs to get out there. WikiLeaks emails. Hillary looked into Parkinson's drug after suffering from decision fatigue. Wow, that is spooky, deceptive, wrote Clinton. Or that is spooky, descriptive. Excuse me, I'm having a Freudian slip about what I really think she thinks. Emails released by WikiLeaks show that Hillary Clinton looked into a drug used to treat sleepiness and Parkinson's disease after she apparently began suffering from decision fatigue. Oh, boy, her own email, she has decision fatigue. That's exactly what Donald Trump's been saying. She goes out, gives us a 10-minute speech, disappears for 3 days, napping. And they come out and they say, how dare you, claim that this lady doesn't have stamina? We're not saying there aren't women that have more stamina than men. In fact, a lot of old women have more stamina than old men, in my experience. Case in point, my grandmother's. Women live longer than men. No one's saying that. We're saying Hillary Clinton looks like she got run over by a bus. And half the time looks like a crew of insane monkeys did her hair. I mean, she walks out and just looks all bedraggled. What is going on with this woman? They're getting her out of bed. She has to run off. A guy follows her around with a pen in his hand that basically injects you with different types of tranquilizers. They won't tell us what type. Incredible. Clinton sent an email to close confidant advisor Cheryl D. Mills on August 9, 2011. This is 5 years later, folks. Now, she looks like hell now. Featuring the text of an article entitled, Do You Suffer from Decision Fatigue? The article talks about how people in positions of power and influence suffer from decision fatigue that causes them to be low on mental energy and promotes the sufferer to become reckless and impulsive. And it goes on to say it can also treat Parkinson's. But there's nothing going on here. There's nothing to be seen. Go back to sleep, everyone. I'm going to stop right there. And we're going to come back and get into this article that has been put up by the Daily Caller. Joe Biggs shot a video on it. It's on Infowars.com. U.S. Army slide lists Hillary Clinton as a security threat. We'll also get into the latest Uma Abedin. That's Hillary's girlfriend that runs the Radical Muslim Journals, where it says that women should basically be kept inside like parakeets. Huma, but it's okay because she's trendy. Huma Abedin left classified material unsecured in the front seat of her car. That's okay. Trump calls for independent investigation of Clinton email crimes. Giuliani says Clinton Foundation is a racketeering enterprise, took money from criminals and dictators. But before I go any further, my friends, I have to remember to breathe, folks. I'm so fired up here on air. I want to just remind you that this special will end tonight, because we have to hold some back for folks that are signed up for AutoShip. By the way, you get 10% off additionally on any discounts when you are signed up for AutoShip at InfoWarsStore.com. And you also get 20% off on Living Defense until it ends today. And it's scores of different herbs and plant extracts that are known to cleanse your body of harmful organisms, parasites, you name it. Take advantage of that today. And you can also order some of the other products while you're at it, like Hillary for Prison. And we also have some other specials running, like get the Amerigeddon film for $19.95 exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. And you can get a free bottle of colloidal silver or three of my DVD films free. So you get two of the films, you get free colloidal silver or three of my films free, great for your archive, great to donate to the library, great to share in the InfoWar. So Armageddon available exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsLife.com is the subsection where you can also order or call toll-free 888-253-3139, and you make it all possible. This is teleprompter free. Sometimes transcendent, other times a train wreck. Always informative. Roger Stone's airplane should be touching down about now, and we're like 10 minutes from the airport. She should be here in about 30, 40 minutes for the balance of transmission. Donald Trump is in the ATX today. I guess he'll be arriving later in his wide-body jet aircraft to speak to a capacity crowd at the Travis County Expo Center in North Austin. Our crew will be there. Now, before we do have our guest joining us in studio, there is a lot to cover. But I wanted to first get a little bit more into, it's not that I don't have enough news, I have too much. So I was talking to the crew during the break, and I'm just looking at all this insane stuff to cover, and I'm wondering, where should I start next? This is a short segment, so I'm thinking, let me just read headlines so you know what's coming up in this segment. Let's just do that. Administration near Syrian refugee goal, 9,077 Muslims, 47 Christians. That's CNS News, but that's a total government cover. They've brought in 10,000 refugees into Austin, or I am a possum's uncle. And they always say they're from Syria. That's just the catch-all term. Southern Command warns Sunni extremists infiltrating from the south. FBI reportedly investigating whether Virginia stabbings were ISIS-inspired. And they admit the guy was trying to go join ISIS in Syria and was on a watch list, Fox News, but he yelled Allah Akbar while he stabbed him and tried to cut their heads off. And in fact, we have the clip. But they're wondering whether it was Islamic-related. Here it is.
Attempted ISIS-style beheading taking place inside the United States. The FBI is now investigating after Wasil Faruqi savagely stabbed a man and a woman and allegedly tried to behead them inside a Roanoke, Virginia apartment while yelling Allah Akbar. Now, what's even scarier is that he seems to have chosen his victims at random. He had no relationship with these victims whatsoever. He's been on the radar of authorities since trying to sneak into Syria last year. We're just getting this information into our newsroom. We'll bring you more as we get it.
And by the way, you know, you see these every couple of days in France or Germany. Like I saw one where it was a cop and his cop wife, but they were liberals and they brought the jihadi in and then he killed him. And the liberals were like, well, it's still sweet, loving. And it's always like real creepy where these jihadists will just randomly pick like some family or something and just go in and just stab them in their house or apartment. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And it's like if somebody's yelling Heil Hitler and, you know, shooting black people, is it Nazi related? I mean, this is just getting so ridiculous. So I've got that here. I'm going to cover this a little bit later and get really serious. Hundreds of California children sent home on first day of school due to new vaccine law. Now, that's CBS News. And normally over the years, I would say this is a total hoax, because in the past it was a hoax. Nowhere in the country do they have laws saying you couldn't attend school if you didn't take vaccines. They had regulations saying they wanted you to fill out a form for the health department that you weren't going to take them. It wasn't really a law, it was a regulation. But it was to give you the idea that you were criminal. California passed a law that got rid of religious and conscientious. So basically, it's 9/10 of a forced inoculation. They leave in there medical, where you can go find doctors that say, yeah, you may have an autoimmune response, or yeah, there's inserts in here, so you've got to take this. What you have to do is tell the school nurse or the school, fine, you sign a waiver form saying you indemnify me and will take care of me for any of these insert reactions, and I'll do it. And they'll let you in the school and leave you alone. It's pure criminal intimidation, and is a fraud still, because they imply in the article and the TV story, there's a text of it. It is an article. They load a teleprompter form. They read it off. They call it TV news, but it is an article. So that's a little factoid right there. They imply it is the law and don't tell you about the medical exemption. So there's the facts.
You know they're a liar.
You know they are. All right, let me recap what our top story is today. And then I'm going to burrow into all the news we haven't gotten to yet ahead of Roger Stone, who just landed in Austin, Texas, and is going to be in studio with us later in the hour. Coming into town for Trump's visit to Austin later this afternoon. This is Reuters. OSCE, that is an EU-UN organization. In fact, it is part of the corporate setup that created the UN. The OSCE rights group requests 500 international observers to monitor U.S. presidential vote for Hillary Clinton. But Trump's a kook because he said election fraud exists, but the UN wants 10 times what they had in 2012 to monitor our elections. But I thought there's no such thing as monitoring because Obama said election fraud. What's that? Simply incredible. Meanwhile, the Jerusalem Post comes out, and I'm going to read this whole article later in the third hour today, maybe even the fourth. Our world, Soros' campaign of global chaos. This isn't Alex Jones saying this. The first thing that we see is the megalomaniacal nature of Soros' philanthropic project. No corner of the globe is unaffected by his efforts. No policy area is left untouched. And you can read magazine interviews he gave 30 years ago where he said he believes he is the Messiah, but that he had to keep it secret. A weirdo Nazi collaborator that funds radical jihadists, the new emails are public, to help take over the West. This guy is a demonic freak. And the Jerusalem Post, to their credit, David Knight and I for almost 3 weeks have been asking every day, where's the coverage in the U.S. press? Zero. And they admit this hack. This is his emails. Just so much evil stuff. How to get our guns, how to dissolve our borders. He admits in here it's to rewrite voting districts. Major media outlets in the U.S. have ignored the leak of thousands of emails from billionaire George Soros' Open Society Foundation by the activist group and hacktivist group DC Leaks. The OSF, in the vehicle through which Soros has funneled billions of dollars over the past two decades to nonprofit organizations in the U.S. and throughout the world. Then it goes into how he's funding Hillary, how he's funding jihadis, and all the different things that he's doing, and how horrible and evil he is, and how he wants to attack the police, and how he's funding Black Lives Matter, and how he wants to destabilize. And people say to me, okay, but you know, there's some bad cops. Why are you against Black Lives Matter? Soros created it. It's White House, Justice Department run. It wants a destabilization campaign. You think our government's bad now? Wait till we get a real Soros government. Soros admitted 5 years ago in leaked Politico documents that his group, run by the White House to this day, Media Matters, was going to infiltrate the independent press from within, hire people, and then have them basically claim false reports. That's called espionage in the French. It happened to News Corp. We've had groups connected to this organization try to penetrate us. This isn't a game, people. Do you understand that? Here's another one. So that's Reuters, Jerusalem Post. Now another one. Yahoo News. Worldwide concern over too many immigrants. Study shows Paris tourism chief demand rescue plan as attacks scare off half their visitors. But it doesn't matter. The EU chief, Jean-Claude Juncker, says, quote, borders are the worst invention ever. Yeah, like bulkhead doors on submarines. Those were a horrible one, too. Or when Jacques Cousteau invented the personal diving tanks. That was a horrible invention if you want to go underwater. Without borders, you have no sovereignty. You have no culture. You will be conquered. You'll be overrun. And that's why we have all these clips of people like this particular individual and the head of the Green Party in Europe and the Democratic VP, Joe Biden, saying, it's wonderful, white people are going away. It's good, then things will be happy. And the current VP candidate saying, whites being a minority is good. It'll teach us what it's like. That's not even what's going on here. It's phrasing things, the opposite of what Martin Luther King said, where everything is based on race instead of being based on rights and freedoms that everyone has. That's how they steal all of our rights, is just obsessing over all this garbage. I mean, look at this new one over here. Schools across the country are going to let men compete as women in sports. Utah College formally allows men on women's sports teams, and it's happening all over the country. Yeah, what about getting rid of people's real rights to actually compete in their league? They're getting rid of all definitions, which gets rid of individuality. It's an inverted program of control. And we have them saying get rid of borders completely. But what do they replace it with? Global corporate government run by the founder of the EU, now the head of the UN program on migrants and borders, Peter Sutherland, who says we're bringing in a world government and we're going to use third world populations to overthrow the West, that is the engine of wealth, so that we control it. And because the immigrants won't be able to assimilate and won't be able to get jobs because they bring them in from the worst third world hellholes, they will then be managed by the state but vote for the elite to keep their power structure in place. This is 21st century warfare. It's beyond organized crime. And it goes on from there. But before we go any further, let's shift gears into the organized crime. Giuliani, love him or hate him, he's telling the truth. Clinton Foundation, a racketeering enterprise, took money from criminals and dictators. We know that, but now he's saying it. Now it's going mainstream. That's Trump taking the gloves off. And that's why we have Trump coming out also basically saying the same thing, and then Clinton making a joke about it a few weeks ago. Let's play that montage.
This is an insider versus outsider campaign. She is the consummate, corrupt Washington insider, and she is thoroughly corrupt, and so is the Clinton Foundation. If I were back in my old job as U.S. attorney, I would probably indict the Clinton Foundation as a racketeering enterprise. They took money from money launderers, criminals, dictators, people who abuse women as a matter of government policy. She did favors for those very people who gave money to the Clinton Foundation. For example, UBS gave the Clintons altogether over $1 million. She made a call to the IRS, asking the IRS to go easy on their attempts to get identities from UBS. In my day, that was considered bribery when I was a U.S. attorney, and I prosecuted several very prominent politicians and convicted them of bribery, including two congressmen.
We've got to leave it there. Again, the Clinton Foundation and all those associated say that they are not under investigation and that they've been clear and transparent. So we will stay tuned because there are those who are urging a closer look.
That's the biggest bunch of garbage I have ever heard.
Mr. Mayor, we appreciate your time today.
Bunch of garbage. They are, I believe, under investigation. There was a leak of that just the other day. And number two, if they're not, the Justice Department should be ashamed of itself.
All right, we got to leave it there. Thank you so much for joining Fox News Sunday, sir.
We're going to go to the Trump clip here in just a moment, basically saying the same thing. All they're doing, though, is looking up at the blue sky and saying it's a blue sky. She took $35 million, and her chief of staff took money as well, and then gave the Russians one-fifth of our uranium stockpile. Now, imagine if Trump was giving the Russians our uranium. Imagine if Trump took $100+ million in just the last few years from Gulf states, $24 million from Saudi Arabia that executes gays. But that's okay because these people are morally bankrupt and their supporters, Democrat Party supporters, are cult-like zombies that don't really care about reality. They don't really care about actually having human rights. They want to feel good and feel like they're on the winning team so they can point their finger at other people. Here's Donald Trump.
As the evidence has become public over the last several months, I've become increasingly shocked by the vast scope of Hillary Clinton's criminality. It's criminality. The amounts involved, the favors done, and the significant number of times it was done require an expedited investigation by a special prosecutor immediately. After the FBI or Department of Justice whitewashed Hillary Clinton's email crimes, they certainly cannot be trusted to quickly or impartially investigate Hillary Clinton's new crimes, which happen all the time. The Justice Department is required to appoint an independent special prosecutor because it has proven itself to be, really, sadly, a political arm of the White House.
That's right. And they think you're so stupid. You know, I had a profound thought this morning that I meant to open the show up with, and I even wrote a note to do it and put it in my pocket, but just remembered it. Trump is running like you're smart. Hillary's running like you're stupid. Because he came out and said, we've got incredible election fraud. And they said, you're a kook, doesn't exist. And now the UN is sending a record 500 plus observers saying there's evidence of election fraud in the U.S. I mean, this is amazing. Remember about a month ago or less, 3 weeks ago, $400 million was given to the Iranians in exchange for hostages. And the State Department put out press releases and gave press conferences and says this had nothing to do with this. This is a payment for money owed for more than two decades. And they also told Congress that in a letter. It was lying to Congress. Now, last week they came out and said, okay, it's true in a press conference. We played the clips on Friday. And said, yes, it was a payment for hostages, which now sets the precedent to take Americans as hostages because the State Department will pay you hundreds of millions of dollar bounty. Once you pay the pirate, as Rutger Kipling said, you better get ready to do it again and again and again. I've had people before try to blackmail me. And of course, it was always with made up stuff, too. And I'm just like, go make that up right now. Please do it. Because they've never been in the media. They've never been around. They haven't had thousands of fake allegations made about them before. I have people try to blackmail me on a semi-routine basis. And I tell you, I love it. Because if I ever even did something, I'm not ever going to be blackmailed. Comprende? But the steadfast policy of not being blackmailed by the U.S. government has now been reversed. And so we can now be like Guatemala, or we can now be like Nigeria, or Rwanda, or some areas in the Pacific. And why not? Politico, State Department confirms $400 million was a payoff ransom. Oh, Politico said it, so now it's true. Well, guess what? The conspiracy theorist, weeks and weeks and weeks before you told the truth, called you out as liars. Big steaming bulls, and it ain't Wolf Brand chili. How long's it been since you got a big old steaming bowl of Hillary Clinton BS? Well, about every 5 seconds. Remember the old Wolf Brand chili ads? How long's it been since you had a big steaming bowl of Wolf Brand chili? Well, that's too long. Now, continuing. Unbelievable. State Department has no idea where $400 million Iran money even went. So there's a whole nother facet to that. A big article and some video clips that are very important from the State Department up on Infowars.com by our own Steve Watson. By the way, Steve Watson has a degree in international affairs and in political science and is just as smart. He's the big brother of Paul Joseph Watson, now a major media force in the world. I mean, he's up there, the top 30, 40 people now. He's amazing. And I wish I could get Steve to work for us full time. I've tried, but he likes to play the guitar and be in a band. And I guess that's a good thing. But, you know, Steve, we need you full time, my friend. I just want to say Steve Watson is an amazing guy, just as smart as Paul. And I need every soldier I can get. And it is so frustrating to know he should be a general, and instead he wants to be a sergeant, which is great. Sergeants do great things. They make the fight go around. But I need generals at this time that actually know what they're doing. There's plenty of people out there that want to be generals but actually don't want to do the work. I mean, if you want to use an evil analogy, like I'm Sauron, I mean, he could be a powerful ring wraith in the fight, but we're on the other side, but you know what I mean. So we've got that going on. Speaking of sergeants, staff sergeants, Joe Biggs, who's a great sergeant, he did a report on this World Net Daily Report, and there's also one on Daily Caller, and the Army says they're not going to comment on it, which means it's real. U.S. Army slide lists Hillary Clinton as security threat. And they called me about this yesterday because I was out doing some errands. They go, yeah, the Army has a slide saying she's a threat. And I went, and they listed terrorists in the article. And I thought, that sounds weird. But then I realized it's a security threat like a leaker. And, of course, she is one because she stored stuff on servers knowing it had been penetrated. Now, they list Snowden as a leaker and a security threat and a traitor. And I don't think he is, because he didn't expose people's names. He exposed the unconstitutional programs that are being used to control our country. That's not my opinion. That's the Constitution. That's common sense. But again, we were told forever that this stuff doesn't exist. There's no NSA spying. There's no keyword spying. There's no hubs inside the telecommunications companies that are NSA. But of course, everything whistleblowers told me 19 years ago, 18 years ago, I mean, I was at the cutting edge of exposing this with whistleblowers. But back then, there'd be almost no coverage when I had a Wayne Madsen on or a James Bamford on or you name it. I mean, Wayne Madsen has exposed stuff in the NSA almost as big as Snowden. But see, he did it 18, 19 years ago, but back when they didn't arrest whistleblowers that exposed criminal activity. Nowadays, he'd be locked up or have to run to Russia. Stay with us. We'll be back. From the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas, Paul Joseph Watson from London, England, will be hosting in the fourth hour. I'll probably overlap some into Paul with Roger Stone, former head of Trump's campaign, who is driving here from the airport right now to be in studio with us. Trump, obviously, is going to be getting into Austin very, very soon. And so we should look for some interesting news on that front as well. I want to drill into the war on the family and just the war on the species itself, while the globalists are doing that. But first, I want to get into a very powerful report posted at InfoWars.com. New report, white's actually more likely to be shot by police. Now, we know this, but this has been really put together in a very powerful presentation. And so we're going to be looking at that in detail. Now, before I go to that, and we actually see the graphics and see the FBI's own numbers, it's shocking. Before I go to that, we are ending the Living Defense special today. And I've been doing a Living Defense cleanse. You can do them a couple times a year. It's scores of concentrated herbs and plant extracts that have been known by cultures throughout the world to remove harmful organisms out of the gut, but at the same time, make your body overall more healthy. And I've been doing this. My children have been doing this. It is so good for you, and it's 20% off right now. You can sign up for AutoShip, get an additional 10% off, and all orders of $50 or more have free shipping in perpetuity. 20% off Living Defense Harmful Organism Cleanser ends tonight. InfoWarsLife.com, as we are selling out of our latest run. Now is the time to secure your bottle for this discounted price before we sell out or have to remove the special, which is now happening. Start eliminating toxic and harmful organisms from your body naturally without harmful chemicals. Living Defense uses organic herbs and enzymes to help naturally cleanse harmful organisms from the body. Just read some of the five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com and see what Living Defense is doing for listeners. Stock up and start cleansing now at InfoWarsLife.com before we sell it again. That's InfoWarsLife.com. You can get Living Defense for 20% off, but that will end today. Here's what Scott from an undisclosed location said, five stars. I follow the directions of the bottle, and I have noticed a big difference in how I feel. This is a great product. It just doesn't go after little worms and stuff that most people have. It goes after bacteria and toxic things that are in your body releasing toxins. That's a nice way of saying using your guts like a latrine. Living Defense, love this stuff. Just the smell of it tells me it's the real deal. Dr. Group is the man, And that's Hanchez from San Diego, California. Yeah, it's amazing. And that's why we sell out all the time. Because if you got 30-something ingredients in it, and each one has to be California standards, which basically means you can't find anything in it. I mean, the air has more toxins in it than this does. Then it's really hard to get batches that are that clean. But we do it. And that's why it sells out. It's why a lot of people don't sell nutraceuticals in California, because the law is basically passed where you, it's very hard to do it. But we like to be at the highest standards, so we're able to do it. Also, the new Armageddon film that we exclusively have the rights to until August 3rd. You can get it for $19.95, an amazing film that deals with the globalists and different false flag scenarios like EMPs that they've been known to be looking into and researching. $19.95, get a second copy for $19.95, and then get three of my films free, while supplies last, or a bottle of colloidal silver, Silver Bullet. And when I say while supplies last, I had 20-something titles. We've sold out of 12 titles. We're down to 8 titles. And so as they sell out, we're changing every few hours what videos are available. So you'll get whatever video you order. It's just that they're all going to be sold out soon, and we'll just be selling Armageddon at the regular price. And a lot of folks ask me, you know, why do you discount something out of the gates? It's what I like to do. I mean, I like to give people a good deal, and also I like to get my films out there so that you can donate them to the library, donate them to the local VFW, put them on Access TV, whatever. It's all about reaching out to people, and every person we reach out to is amazing. So Armageddon, now exclusively available at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. That's 888-253-3139. Now, this is a subject fraught with political correctness. But I'm not going to be politically correct, because I genuinely care about everyone. And not because I'm virtue signaling. I have real empathy. If I close the door, which happens invariably once a year or so, on a little pink gecko that are all over my house, no matter where I've lived, they're all over Central Texas, and cut the little guy in half, I get really sad, and I say, oh, I'm sorry, sweetie, and I get a napkin, and if he's flopping around, I crush his little head or her little head, not because I enjoy it, but because I have empathy. And I'm going to be honest with you, I get a tear in my eye. Now, I'm a predator. Humans are designed to be predators, but not against their own species. And so it's complex psychology. But if I go out and shoot a deer, that's a prey animal that as a human I'm designed to kill. Or if I kill it with a bow, or however I take it out, and I'm designed to butcher it, not because I want to kill an animal, but because I'm designed, just like a great white shark eating a seal. But I'm not designed to eat little geckos, so I think of it as like a little baby. It's cute. It's not my prey, so I'm sad. And there are other predator animals that will kill the species they mainly feed on, but then will take in and cuddle and baby another species. Wolves have been documented to take in humans. The globalists are predators against us all, basically. And that's not natural. We don't want to base a society on being predators on each other. That creates an economy of conquest, not of innovation. A system that implodes, not a system that grows. Not a system we want to be in. And there's never a perfect utopia between a Renaissance economy and a barbarous oppression economy. We're always somewhere in between the conquest economy and the free market win-win economy. But I want to move towards the 360 win system. Now, that said, I've studied epigenetics, and I have really looked into it deeply, and most top scientists now across the field of human behaviorism know this is a fact. You call it instincts. And I've studied, and if I was a professor, I'd go do the research and put a paper out. I'd actually quantify it all down, but I'm going from memory here, so this is a gestalt and a dead reckoning. I wouldn't call it scientific, just a theory. Now I'm being a conspiracy theorist. When I do that, I put a hat on to tell folks I'm doing it. But if you look at Europe 1,000 years ago, it was still barbarous, very, very dangerous. And the murder rate, if you go back and look at some of the histories, was very, 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 very high. If you look at England or London specifically, 500, 600 years ago, they banned Christmas for a while because there were riots so bad in London that sometimes tens of thousands of people would die a night and a third of the city would burn down. I mean, look it up for yourself. I've read mainline history books on the subject. It was incredible. And what am I getting at here? There was a thug life, thug culture, where it was cool to run around killing people and just at laissez-faire, rape, murder, burn things down. Christianity was trying to reform that, but in many cases it would break back out. And that was because epigenetically, the people that you saw there, but it was also culture from being barbarians. It wasn't the IQs. These were smart people. It was the culture and the epigenetics of just being a few generations off the farm. But in those days, you had to fight on a basically weekly basis just to not have your farm taken. So it's like street fighting meets the farm. That's why they've got big university studies, you can Google them, showing whether it was somebody in Africa 5,000 years ago or somebody in Europe 5,000 years ago. They were stronger than the strongest power lifters, faster runners than anybody alive today, because they hadn't been brought into modern society and weren't basically being domesticated. So it's an issue of domestication versus being wild. It's not an issue of saying someone's primitive or someone's evil or someone's bad. But see, the globalists aren't coming in to our cultures to try to domesticate us so we're nice and loving and like Star Trek. They are doing this to absolutely make us stand down and be overrun and enslaved. So I think it's good to get back to being more primitive, because that's not primitive in the word. That's more advanced when it comes to standing up for yourself. But the globalists know how to manipulate that. And they have beta tested, first with rock and roll, rebellion in the 60s and the sexual revolution to break up the family. And I'm not up here on a high horse about sex. I'm simply, and I have read the white papers on this, so most of this is documented fact. They did it to break down the family, to break down the culture. They beta tested in black communities, particularly bioweapons and drug dealing. So a lot of that's been done culturally also to create a higher crime rate. But then they used gangster rap and other systems in the 80s. This has come out, CIA, to create a culture, a fake warrior culture of killing each other for pointless reasons and not caring, to prep people for the prison population. Now the globalists have moved on worldwide with this weaponized system against everyone. And it's had devastating effects. And we've talked a lot about that. And I've talked to major rock stars, major record executives, some of the biggest in the world off record, not people you've heard on air. Also, maybe some you have, but these aren't the ones I'm talking about. Where they were there in the 90s saying, you better get into gangster thugism or you're not going to be on air. What do you mean? We're at the top of the charts. We don't care. We've been directed to go with this. That's why you see kind of rap country music now that's all thugged out and rock and roll that's all thugged out. That's a directive that if you want to be on air, you do that. And this is to artificially express epigenetics to be violent. And to try to artificially bring those back. And so that's what's going on here. But it doesn't matter if you are, say, a white person being targeted by racist black people, because in the cosmology, you deserve it because you're bad at some form of reparations. It has to be decried as racist and evil. But the left is covering it up because they want to continue this paradigm on into the future so that they can imprison populations while claiming they represent them. But paint them with the red letter of criminal while using that threat to then set up a police state that controls all the other so-called populations. And by that, really, just middle-class populations that have escaped poorer areas. This is systems of social engineering. And you can look at the statistics. Some of the best statistics in the world come from the FBI because statistics started in the modern age with the FBI. That's well known. Some of them are adulterated. Certainly, some crime statistics get manipulated, but they're amongst some of the best because it's hard to cover up, you know, the actual number of murders, say, in the United States. Things like rape obviously are underreported. But when it comes to armed robbery, bank robberies, that's well documented, and almost all of it is on record. So when these big studies come out proving this, the media doesn't want to cover it because it doesn't fit into the worldview that inherently white people are evil, and that's why these problems are happening. The truth is there are evil people of every color, who joined together in organized crime syndicates to prey on the general public by keeping us dumbed down, by keeping us in the dark, and by manipulating us, and then by setting up false cultures that we're supposed to follow that are designed to sabotage and destroy us. And basically prep some of the pre-existing problems in the system to exacerbate it and not let the crisis go to waste. So that said, Heather McDonald with Prager University made a very powerful video that's up on Infowars.com in a report, White's actually way more likely to be shot by police. And it gets into a lot more than just that. And these are the latest numbers. Now, it's just like what we see with gun crime. Crimes using guns have been flat the last few years. It was dropping since 1992, over 60% on average. But the perception is there's massive, massive, massive crime with guns being used. There's also a perception that police officers are killing blacks at exponential en masse. That's used as the cover by the very people that on record social engineered in the 50s and 60s as a beta test the black community. Now, again, it's come out, the secret testing in the black community, but the media will only cover it when it's the black community, not because they care about black people, but because when this stuff first started coming out, it could be seen as more palatable with a background of real racism that was stronger at the time to then have the whole thing be shut down. When you actually research, there's secret testing going on against everybody in every major country, against every major military. The globalist religion is about suppressing and controlling populations. And it's all about constantly testing scientifically to understand how we tick, to know how to control us. And to train and test the testers to see what populations will they test on, what will they do. In fact, almost all the children that were radiated to death during and after the atomic project, the Manhattan Project, were white, poor white children. But they actually got some religious groups in the country to even donate their children and their young men to be tested on lethally. Now, if you don't believe me, you need to research that. And by the way, I know this sounds incredible, folks, but that's how controlled some of the Christian groups in this country were. They believed like Christ to actually go submit to being killed in many cases. That's the Seventh-day Adventists, by the way. So this is hardcore, folks. This is hardcore. You need to understand this. Let's go to this report. This is something they do not want you to see. When you get this out to everybody, here it is.
Does the truth matter? Not to groups like Black Lives Matter. That's tragic for many reasons, not the least of which is that Black lives are being lost as a result. When it comes to the subject of American police, blacks, and the deadly use of force, here is what we know. A recent deadly force study by Washington State University researcher Lois James found that police officers were less likely to shoot unarmed black suspects than unarmed white or Hispanic ones in simulated threat scenarios. Harvard economics professor Roland Fryer analyzed more than 1,000 officer-involved shootings across the country. He concluded that there is zero evidence of racial bias in police shootings. In Houston, he found that blacks were 24% less likely than whites to be shot by officers, even though the suspects were armed or violent. Does the truth matter? An analysis of the Washington Post's police shooting database and of federal crime statistics reveals that fully 12% of all whites and Hispanics who die of homicide are killed by cops. By contrast, only 4% of black homicide victims are killed by cops. But isn't it a sign of bias that blacks make up 26% of police shooting victims, but only 13% of the national population? It is not, and common sense suggests why. Police shootings occur more frequently where officers confront armed or violently resisting suspects. Those suspects are disproportionately black. According to the most recent study by the Department of Justice, although blacks were only about 15% of the population in the 75 largest counties in the U.S., they were charged with 62% of all robberies, 57% of murders, and 45% of assaults. In New York City, blacks commit over 3/4 of all shootings, though they are only 23% of the city's population. Whites, by contrast, commit under 2% of all shootings in the city, though they are 34% of the population. New York's crime disparities are repeated in virtually every racially diverse city in America. The real problem facing inner city black communities today is not the police, but criminals. In 2014, over 6,000 blacks were murdered, more than all white and Hispanic homicide victims combined. Who is killing them? Not the police and not white civilians, but other blacks. In fact, a police officer is 18 and a half times more likely to be killed by a black male than an unarmed black male is to be killed by a police officer. If the police ended all use of lethal force tomorrow, it would have a negligible impact on the black death by homicide rate. In Chicago, through just the first 6.5 months of 2016, over 2,300 people were shot. That's a shooting an hour during some weekends. The vast majority of the victims were black. During the same period, the Chicago police shot 12 people, all armed and dangerous. That's 0.5% of all shootings. Does the truth matter? If it does, here's a truth worth pondering. There is no government agency more dedicated to the proposition that black lives matter than the police. The proactive policing revolution that began in the mid-1990s has dramatically brought down the inner city murder rate and saved tens of thousands of black lives. Unfortunately, that crime decline is now in jeopardy. As I write in my book, The War on Cops, police officers are backing off of proactive policing in black neighborhoods thanks to the false narrative that police officers are infected with homicidal bias. As a result, violent crime is going up. In cities with large black populations, homicides in 2015 rose anywhere from 54% in Washington, D.C. to 90% in Cleveland. Overall, in the nation's 56 largest cities, homicides in 2015 rose 17%, a nearly unprecedented one-year spike. Many law-abiding residents of high-crime areas beg the police to maintain order, precisely the type of policing that the ACLU, progressive politicians, and the Obama Justice Department denounce as racist. This is tragic because when the police refrain from proactive policing, black lives are lost. Lost because of a myth. The best research and data reach this conclusion. There is no evidence that police are killing blacks just because they're black. You now have the truth. Does it matter? I'm Heather McDonald of the Manhattan Institute for Prager University.
I want to be clear. Everyone knows this that's ever followed what I've done over 20 plus years, that I'm known as the anti-police state guy. I'm known as the person that's against warrantless seizures. I'm the guy against that warned of drones and that warned of the NSA spying and that warned of all the different red light cameras and systems. But you talk to the average cop, they don't like all that. They say, tell the politicians to change it. I'm not one of these people, though, that's just in some mindless love fest with police because I like to watch cop shows on TV. I understand the formulae that has been used to overthrow countless countries in the 20th and 21st century by communists. And you ask, well, you say it's megabanks doing this. Why is it the same formula? Because it was megabanks in 1917, this is undisputed history, that funded the Bolshevik Revolution. They wanted a group of communists to run the country, enslave the people, and make deals with them for raw material. Communism is a tool of the ultra-tax-exempt rich. That's why Warren Buffett supports it. That's why Henry Kissinger supports it. That's why Ted Turner supports it. That's why Bill Gates supports it, because they're tax-exempt. And until people figure out this paradigm and read the book, None Dare Call a Conspiracy, from their own documents, I think we still sell that book. We don't have a future. It's finally back in print. I know we were selling it for a while. Is it available? InfoWarsStore.com? I think it is. It's a short little book. It's got their quotes. And until you realize the ultra-rich are waging war on prosperity, we have no future. Everyone should order None Dare Call a Conspiracy by Gary Allen. His son went on to start Politico. Shameful. The late, great Gary Allen with Larry Abraham. None Dare Call a Conspiracy. The most important book other than the Bible you will ever read. Veritas. Pure, unadulterated Veritas. 4.9 stars, available in stock, InfoWarsStore.com. By the way, I didn't even mean to plug right now. I was just thinking of that. And by the way, I didn't just believe that book once I got on radio and TV. I had myself and my one or two crew members early on who were volunteers. We went to the UT library and others. We'd do day trips sometimes to Dallas and places. Or listeners would go to the microfiche in New York or D.C. and send us stuff in the mail. The real patriots, you know who you are out there listening today. With the actual quotes from the Congressional Record and newspapers going back decades that were in None Dare Call It. The book's all true. I wanted to know if David Rockefeller said that Mao Zedong was wonderful and we should have communism. I got the New York Times where he said it. I put it in the film. I show it to you. I went to the UT microfiche and I got it. What I'm saying is I know what I'm talking about. These people are evil. They put Mao in. He killed 80-something million of his own people. And by the way, speaking of evil, the Bill Clinton rape shirt that helps spread the word funds this operation, available exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com. We're bringing Roger Stone in right now. Roger Stone, ladies and gentlemen. I had been thinking he was flying in from Dallas. No, he flew into Dallas and then did an event there and then drove here through I-35 that has famously bad traffic. So he was going to do 2 hours with us. Now he's going to do an hour with us. But he's here in Austin for Donald Trump's visit tonight. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. First off, Roger, great to see you.
See you.
What's coming up in the next hour?
We're going to talk about Hillary's health and the way the mainstream media is trying to cover for her. We're going to talk about the potential theft of this election through voter machine manipulation. Not voter fraud, very different issue. We're going to talk about the new Trump campaign team and how that's working out. We're going to talk about some recently uncovered lies by Hillary Clinton about the Ukraine, or about Ukraine, pardon me. And of course, we're going to promote our iconic rape T-shirt, which is really taken off.
That's really upset Media Matters. And I saw they got really upset, White House run, that you would dare go to a big book signing in Dallas. And they've come out and said Breitbart, for me, this was huge a few days ago, Breitbart and other independent media does not have a right to exist.
Yeah, no, it's a censorship is the, you know, it worked for Hitler, it worked for Stalin, and now they're trying to make sure that it works for Hillary. They can't refute what we have to say, so they have to try to discredit us, call us names, and block anybody from interviewing.
And they started with you, first time I ever saw this, announcing you were banned on CNN, the next day MSNBC said, and then you learned quietly that you haven't been back on Fox. I mean, I guess that might thaw someday, but we just have these bannings now. It's the new McCarthyism.
Yeah, fortunately, of course, we reach so many more people here at InfoWars and at other outlets. But, yeah, it's the only response that they have.
Let's talk about that first. Well, Roger Stone has worked inside, four different White Houses, been involved in 9 different campaigns. I met him years ago at a JFK conference and, you know, shook his hand, talked to him. And then I said, I've seen that guy before, but didn't really click that he did was like the second in command of the Bush recount in Florida. And, of course, was the main confidant of Richard Nixon after he got out of office. Was the guy that actually got Nixon to go out and start talking to the press and going on TV again. I mean, Roger Stone, you can sit there and Google stuff about him. It's interesting and spend hours, you know, reading New York Times articles about him from the 70s, 80s and 90s. But he's really an interesting guy now. Of course, longtime confidant of Donald Trump, his first campaign manager, a guy that really helped push Trump, you know, to make his own decision to run. And then we've seen several other campaign heads now, Lewandowski, your business partner, Manafort. And now we have Bannon, who I know you're a huge fan of.
Big fan.
And who I know has taken Breitbart in a really powerful direction. Basically, he's not copying InfoWars. He's got his own investigative journalist, more than I've got, out just reading the emails and discovering it's New World Order, it's world government. They plan to censor the press. So we're going to do an hour and a half, 30 minutes into Watson next hour. He'll ride shotgun with us. But I want to cover the waterfront here with Roger Stone of StoneZone.com. We carry two of his latest best-selling books, The Clinton's War on Women and The Bush Crime Family, that show how they really work together, how that whole power structure is out to basically take over the country. More important than ever, his crew designed the Bill Clinton rape shirt that looks like the Hope shirt, exclusively available at InfoWarsStore.com. The first thing I want to cover with Roger Stone today, I love showing the rape shirt because it caused Sinker Ugarik, or whatever his name is, the Young Turds, to totally flip out when he saw you 20 feet away walking by with it. I mean, he's just crazy. But before we get back into that, Drudge came here a year ago, and he said, listen, I talked to a Supreme Court justice. I talk about this every day because it's so pertinent now. It's happening. And he said, next year they're going to start the process of handing the internet over to the UN. They're going to start censoring. They're going to turn loose the Federal Elections Commission. And they're going to start shutting down the independent patriot media. I talked to sources, and I can also hear the Democrats, the czars, the senators saying, shut down Drudge, Federal Elections Commission, shut down News Corp, Fox, shut down Limbaugh. And then they started saying, shut down InfoWars. I'm political. Well, yeah, I mean, if being pro-gun is political, damn right I am. So, but I'm a libertarian. Cut my teeth going after Clinton and the Bushes, you name it. Just like you've been, you know, critical of Bush after you learned what he was doing in Iraq. I'm just setting the table here that we're not just saying this. It's now in public Democratic Party fundraising emails, Daily Caller, InfoWars, and of course Breitbart reported on it last week to say, quote, mainline conservatives have a right to exist. Well, that means they want to get them too. What a creepy term. It's like Final Solution. Jews have no rights to exist. Then they say, but groups like Breitbart don't, and when we get Hillary in, we're shutting them down. Breitbart is way bigger than the New York Times. Drudge is the number one news site in the world with more traffic than Facebook, Twitter, the New York Times combined. Now, down that list of the top 100 sites, if you combine how they said free speech systems and my other sites individually had us at like 80 and 90, we're like 50. And technically, I'm not bragging here, but we're bigger than Breitbart when it comes to overall, not just our site, but the whole aggregate. I don't want to be bigger than Breitbart. I want to defeat the New World Order. I'm glad Breitbart's big. I hope it gets 10 times bigger. The point is, when I say they're coming after the free press, they had a coup at Fox. They now admit they infiltrated. They admit the White House is involved. They admit Democrats are involved. Media Matters and memos said they were going to infiltrate. We're next. So that means you're next, folks. When they take away your voice, they take everything away. So we can put the Daily Caller headline up there where they said, no right to exist for Breitbart. When they say that, they now see Breitbart as the lead elephant because of Stephen Bannon. Now, you've got the floor to talk about free speech, the attacks, the demonization, the season we are in of disinformation. Roger Stone.
Yeah, Alex, you're absolutely right. Last week, I spoke on C-SPAN about the easy ability to hack these election machines, these computerized voting machines, citing a study at Stanford University that shows that the Clintons have already done it to Bernie Sanders in at least 12 states. Also citing the work of a Princeton professor, a professor at Columbus State Community College, Robert Fitrakis, who wrote a terrific book, Strip and Flip and Strip, about how these machines are manipulated. So there's no mechanical engineering or scientific evidence that the machines cannot be fixed easily. Therefore, their argument is, well, we have to rely on the integrity of the Clintons not to do this. Sorry, but this election is easily rigged. Now, when I said that, Media Matters for America, the Hillary front group run by David Brock, immediately demanded that C-SPAN ban me. Whenever I published a long piece at The Hill, they immediately began to demand that The Hill ban Roger Stone, as if my views are not valid, only their views are valid. It's censorship. It worked for Hitler, it worked for Stalin, and now they're trying to make it work for Hillary Clinton.
I want you to continue, but just think about, I'm almost breathless here. This is so epic, so historic, where they actually call for you to be banned. When they ordered MSNBC and CNN to ban you, they did it. They are the talking points, and now they admit in the emails the White House is meeting with Google. It's meeting with Facebook, Twitter, weekly. It's meeting with CNN. It's telling them what to do, what questions to ask, everything to say, and now they're promising to actually shut us down, our own outlets, if they get in. This is now a referendum, this election, on the free press more than anything. And then that's A. And then B, they said Donald Trump was insane 3 weeks ago. when he came out and said they tried to steal the nomination from me. They did from Bernie. We need to have election watchers. Now the UN, Reuters is reporting, for the Clintons and the Justice Department is asking for 10 times the monitors they had in 2012 to basically run the elections. And as you warned last time you were on, before they did this, you said, I would watch the watchers. That's who will be stealing. Go ahead, Roger Stone.
That's exactly right, Alex. I mean, a couple things are going on here at once. First of all, anyone who raises questions about the Clintons, their record, their corruption, Bill's history as a sexual predator, you're immediately branded a conspiracy theorist. Now, you know the genesis of that phrase. It goes back to 1964, CIA memo that said, anytime anybody surfaces to question the results of the Warren Commission and President Kennedy's death, immediately brand them as a conspiracy theorist in order to undermine their credibility. Here we are again. They keep accusing us of being conspiracy theorists. No, we're conspiracy realists. Because we continue to point out the crimes of the Clintons, and we're not going to stop. We continue to point out the lies of the Clintons, and we're not going to stop. What I found, Alex, it's really chilling. I've yet to be verified at Twitter. People keep setting up fake Roger Stone profiles, and they try to launch them. And I've asked several times to be verified. I've provided all their forms, all their information, the fact that I have this problem on Twitter, yet I cannot get verified. I was denied yet again today. More disturbing, though, is that I put up a provocative tweet about Hillary Clinton that's factual. People will retweet it. Then they contact me and they say, I retweeted what you put up, but it's disappeared.
Well, they now admit, Google admits that they are delisting the Clinton death list. They are delisting Donald Trump. They are delisting basically her health problems. And the New York Times asked them a few days ago in an op-ed, said, please delist her health problems and her health videos. So they're now communicating the establishment from the New York Times to Google. Oh, by the way, we forgot to whack this mole, ban this.
Yeah, no, it's exactly true, which is, I think, a great segue into the question of Hillary's health. The spokesman for Hillary Clinton attacked me by name several days ago, saying that this was all a right-wing conspiracy and that I am promoting documents online that are forgeries.
You never put those up.
I never put them up. I find them interesting. I have no idea whether they're real or not real, but my concerns about Hillary's health come from my own eyes, the photographs, the videos.
Her being in the hospital for a year in 2012-13, her stumbling around. Look, we have medical doctors on Fox News, the heads of major university divisions, coming out saying, quote, it's no conspiracy theory. We now have a WikiLeak coming out with her wanting Parkinson's medication in her emails.
Yeah, it's extraordinary that they are running a cover-up on this when my view on her health is not based on some document online that may or may not have been real. I didn't even read it.
Well, looks like she's already in a coffin.
Well, and she's got an ulcer on her tongue. She's got her head snapping around like she's on The Exorcist. What's that about?
So, yeah, where's the green pea soup?
Exactly. I mean, she's got no stamina. I think it's abundantly clear. She, as Donald Trump has correctly said, she does a campaign day where she does one stop. They limit access to the press. And then she takes 5 days off and does another stop. She doesn't have the stamina or the mental clarity or the balance to be president of the United States. That's not conjecture. You can see this with your own eyes.
I want to go to break and come back and get into the health stuff. But what about just the arrogance of Obama for 6 days? He finally went today. Never going to worse flooding than Katrina. And then Hillary is flying planes 20 miles from Martha's Vineyard to Nantucket. And they just don't even care to go when this is what they destroyed the Republicans with in 2008, was Bush's response to Katrina. There's such a disconnect.
Yeah, no, they excoriated Bush for doing exactly what they are doing, not taking care of business. This is the job of
the
president.
But to be fair, and I don't want to defend Bush, he went down there. I mean, they just didn't give a damn.
No, that's exactly right. But it was election time, and therefore they needed to undermine him. Now Obama doesn't do the job that he's elected to. And nobody says anything. It's
Does that just show arrogance, disconnect, that she's ill? I mean, why didn't she run down there?
Well, she's probably not well enough to move around, and they don't want to expose her.
I watched a video of her walking down the plane ramp the other day, and she looked like she was bracing each step like she was in hell.
Yeah, the woman's not well. It's visually obvious, and now we have the big lie. It's all our fault that her health is bad. We're making the whole thing up because we're conspiracy
theorists. Stay right there, because I have a concern. My gut tells me, Roger Stone, that she's obviously seriously ill, but she might coast in like a dead rat bouncing into the White House. What happens if that takes place? We'll be right back. At the end of the hour, into the fourth hour, and open the phones up. In fact, I'm going to give the number out right now. Your questions for Roger Stone about all things election 2016 and what's happening with Trump. But when this election's over, where I'm flying you back to Austin, I want to do 2-3 hours with you just about the whole history of the Republican Party in the modern age, Nixon, you know, all the books you've written on those subjects, and just all the interesting lore that Roger Stone has for us, and inside views and perspectives. But I was thinking during the break about censorship again before we get back into the medical issues and how they respond, because the two stories go together. Bezos of Amazon, who admits he's a Clinton worshiper, another multi-billionaire, you know, socialist, owns the Washington Post and makes it even worse than it was before.
Which is hard to do.
Which is hard to do, with Graham running it before. Now,
the worst newspaper in America.
Now we've got Carlos Slim, who owned part of it. Now he's the majority owner of the New York Times.
And the largest single donor to the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton Global Initiative. He's number one.
Engaged in incredible disinformation. But no wonder they want to censor us and now admit they want to shut us down, with a 6% national trust rating in an AP study of tens of thousands of respondents. It's bigger than just wanting to shut us down. We have to understand, I mean, I'm not bragging, InfoWars reaches 28 million people a week. This radio show, just on terrestrial radio, 3 million people a day, over 5 million YouTube views, over 3 or 4 million Facebook views a day. You add it all together, it's much bigger than 28 million. That's conservative. These people are a joke, and they already know they've collapsed. Roger Stone, that only means it's that much worse. They are coming to shut us down, like Matt Drudge said.
Yeah, no, I think their plan is painfully obvious. Here's the difference between what we're seeing now and everything I've seen in 8 previous presidential campaigns. In the past, the media pretended to be objective. They still tried to screw the conservative candidate, but all the time pretending to be objective. Now, they've dropped all pretense of trying to be objective. It is hysterical in their efforts to get Donald Trump, to smear him, to distort what he says, to magnify minor mistakes that he's made. He's not a career politician, as he said the other day, which I think was actually very positive. He doesn't always get it exactly right. But when he makes a small mistake, they magnify it out of all proportion. When Hillary gets caught taking bribes or lying, they barely cover it. In fact, most cases, they don't cover it at all. They've dropped all pretense of being objective. Now, they just seek to stop the reform candidacy of Donald Trump because it scares the daylights out of them. He would bust up the K Street, Wall Street combine.
None of them are giving him any money. That is the total certification. He's the real deal.
Yeah, yesterday's finance report showed him at $38 million cash on hand. In retrospect, it may become clear, if he raises the same amount in, say, the next 80 days, which is probable, that he would have been better off taking public finance and then running as much fundraising he could through affiliated super PACs, as Hillary has done with her super PACs. He would have gotten $100 million from public finance without raising a dime. And he would
that was
have,
your recommendation, wasn't
I
it?
Did recommend that, yes. And I think it's going to be borne out as he would have had more net dollars for the fight had he done so.
Well,
no, the establishment has zipped their wallets.
This is so colossal. I overuse the word epic, but this is the epic of epic. This is the creme de la creme, where the evil, corrupt Pope, the evil, corrupt Chinese president, the evil, corrupt Mexican president, the Saudi, corrupt filth, royal family, every festering nest of corruption and evil hates Donald Trump, every global combine, every stinking hedge fund. And then the moron fake liberals run around behind Hillary. But a lot of them I talk to actually aren't morons and are supporting Trump because they know Sanders was stolen. I think that's really the missing army that will put Trump over the top. And that's why I think there's election fraud if he doesn't win.
This is why the candidacy of both Jill Stein, the Green Party candidate, and Gary Johnson, the Libertarian Party candidate, are so important. The criteria of the Presidential Commission on Debates, which is, by the way, not appointed by the president, not a commission. and not about debates. It's headed by a former Republican national chairman and Democratic national chairman. Their goal, keep everybody else out of the political discussion. Now, I think progressive voters would vote for Jill Stein, given the screwing of Bernie Sanders without Vaseline, according to the WikiLeaks documents, where Deborah Wasserman Schultz was a mole for the Clintons, if they knew that her candidacy existed. She has gotten on the ballot in 44 states.
All I see is leftist groups attacking her, but that's because they're not real leftist groups.
No, it's McCarthyism. That's McCarthyism. She's a legitimate candidate. Governor Gary Johnson's a legitimate candidate. They should be in these debates, first of all. It is outrageous to not include them.
Sure.
Using some phony polling number creates the chicken and egg situation where they can't get to 15% because they're not in the debate, and they can't get in the debate because they're not at 15%. The criteria should be, how many states are you on the ballot
on? Sure, but we can never break the two-headed monster duopoly, so Trump finally came in and has done that. He's taken over the Republican Party in a libertarian populist insurrection, and that's why everyone needs to support him, including Sanders people. We'll be back. Roger Stone's in studio with us, 30 minutes in the next hour. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. I want to get into Manafort, and I know the true scoop on this, and I know what went on, and there's no truth to it, and that'll be coming out in the next few weeks. I'm going to stop there. We're not going to get much into that today, but some. But I really want to get into Trump here in a moment because, again, Reuters, Associated Press, they're all reporting the Justice Department is bringing in the UN and the European Union. This is Reuters. At tenfold the number they had 4 years ago to oversee the election because they're so concerned about fraud, but they admit it's run by the Justice Department. So they're going to go in there to, I guess, carry out the fraud. That's what you warned of 3 weeks ago on air. And it says right here, a tenfold increase from the number of the group deployed in 2012. We're going to get back to that here in just a moment. But how are they still criticizing Trump like he is an insane pterodactyl or something from another age? Obama's like, what election fraud? What are you talking
ridiculous.
About?
Ridiculous. He said it's ridiculous. Yesterday, the New York Times quotes this political science professor in California, Hassan, who says this is laughable. No, it's not laughable. It's a reality. First of all, Alex, let's distinguish between voter fraud and election theft. These are two different issues.
Yeah, the UN's coming in to make sure election fraud can't happen. They call it fraud if we don't let illegals vote.
Yeah, exactly. So what's happened here is the State Department has a set of criteria in which they judge foreign elections in terms of fairness.
So the headline is UN coming to the U.S. to make sure illegals can vote. Sorry, go ahead.
I think the real issue here is the State Department standards for fair elections have been violated by Hillary in at least 12 primaries against Bernie. That's how bad the steal is there. That's why he has switched his registration from Democrat back to an independent in Vermont. What kind of signal does that send about Hillary's candidacy? And it's an absurdity to think that the Clintons won't steal something that they can steal. The issue of voter fraud, meaning people voting multiple times, people who are not eligible voting, dead people who are still on the rolls voting, that is a more limited problem. It's not non-existent, as the folks at Huffington Post say. It's very much existent, but it is dwarfed by the seriousness of the ability to rig these computerized voter machines. We have a professor at Princeton, a professor in Ohio State Community College. We have the Stanford
study. Former Diebold chief engineers.
We have the Stanford study. We have a CBS video, not exactly right-wing media, showing us how a $15 device that you can get at Radio Shack or Best Buy's will allow you to vote multiple times without being detected. So are we counting on the goodwill and the integrity of the Clintons not to steal something which is technologically easily
but
stealable?
But wait, I mean, they've got Jed Johnson and they've got Loretta Lynch. They're going to run it and keep it safe with the UN. I mean, they're good people. We can trust them, can't we?
Yeah, that's very concerning. You got, as I said earlier on the program, you've got to watch the watchers. You've got to watch the watchers. Now, how can you combat that? This is the real question. We have re-energized StopTheSteal.org. StopTheSteal.org has several goals. Number one, we're going to demand inspection of the software for these voting machines in every jurisdiction where we suspect that there will be rigging. If they will not let independent third parties examine the software, it'll be clear that the fix is in. Secondarily, we're going to conduct exit polls right outside the polling places to be able to match the exit poll results with the machine results. Now, exit polls are scientifically and historically far more accurate than any form of voting.
And that's undisputed.
Undisputed.
It's way better than polls.
And here's the reason for this. Because you're getting the voters' intention before they've heard the results. You see, once they hear the results, and over time, they begin to gravitate to the winner. People want to have been with the winner. But if you get them as they exit the booth, they're far more likely to tell you the
truth. And that's why they come out and say for a month, he's dropping out, he's dropping out, he's dropping out. Intervention, intervention, intervention.
Yes.
He's insane, he's insane, he's insane. He's bankrupt, he's bankrupt. His wife's a prostitute. Even though they had to reverse all that and apologize because of a lawsuit, it's all made up, all fake, is because they're creating the perception he's way behind on all the polls. They've got another polling company came out, not just Reuters, and added more Democrats to samples than Republicans. When Trump still won, they added more Democrats.
Yeah, Gallup got busted. So
I mean, there's no end to these people.
And this is an important part of the plan. Here's how it works. First, we rig the polls to create a public perception. Then we rig the machines to meet that perception.
First you rig the polls
to create the perception of what will happen. Then you rig the machines to meet the perception that you've created. That's how this works. It's a legitimate issue, but when you get out there and discuss these things, even with the backing of a Stanford study, a Princeton professor, this professor Dr. Fetrakis, who's a terrific guy, they call you a conspiracy theorist.
I was about to say, though, we've got the heads of universities, all these scientists, Democrats, mainline TV hosts that are doctors saying she's clearly got neurological problems. Now we have her email saying, I need Parkinson's medication. That is bombshell.
Well, we have an email in which she said that she cracked her head. I'm not doing too good with a cracked head, she says in the email. I read that one this morning from WikiLeaks. She clearly has a health problem. We didn't make it up. We're not falsifying it.
Then let's go back to my question.
See with your own two eyes.
Let's go back to my question. It's my fault. I never brought it back up because we went to break. If they steal it, they're already writing articles that they're scared Trump's going to challenge it, or they're planting the idea his candidacy was fake because he might want to start a Patriot Network. Well, I read back 5 years ago he wanted to do that to save the country. Thank God if they cheat Trump, he's not planning on giving up.
Yeah, he's not going to roll over. Look, you have to have real evidence. You can't just lose and then say, oh, this was stolen from me. This is why the StopTheSteal.org operation is so important. We're going to have properly run, scientifically based exit polls.
Roger, I agree, and you're doing that. You've done a great job, yep. And we're going to be there with you. And we're going to support it. The listeners are going to go be part of it. I mean, they're ready. What I'm saying is if they stole all those primaries from him, but he said no and they had to back off, they stole it from Bernie openly.
Right.
We have evidence that she's an illegitimate nominee, and that's what I've been arguing the whole time. Don't just go out and say there's election fraud, we've got to watch it. So when they do it, people understand that it was already an issue. What about the fact that she's an illegitimate candidate? That goes to your fact we should bring in other people from the debates.
Well, the Democrats are the only ones who could object to that, and they're not going to because the Clintons have mau-mau'd most of the Democrats.
Sure, but in the court of public opinion, I think he makes that an issue, that this woman stole her nomination, which they now have Stanford University, as you said.
Yes.
Did the research last week, came out.
And in 12 states, they violated her own standards as Secretary of State for transparent elections.
Other people's countries.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. She goes and monitors other elections. Obama goes and monitors, but he's never heard of problems in elections.
By the way, the problems we're talking about are problems that former President Jimmy Carter has specifically criticized abroad and has criticized mildly in the United States.
In fact, I saw where he actually came out and said, no, it's true. We have problems.
Yes. So he certifies that these machines have been rigged. You know, say anything you want. He figures out that Bernie Sanders got
it. I
got
to hand it to him. But despite all his problems, at the end of the day, he really says what he thinks.
I think he believes in democracy. I was never a great fan. Obviously, I helped defeat him in his efforts to get a second term while working for Governor Ronald Reagan. But in this issue, I think he is a forceful spokesman, and I hope he will speak out more on the question of voter fraud and election rigging.
All right. So much energy, so much to cover, so much happening. I want to get into Manafort. I want to get into the whole Ukraine disinfo. I want to cover the waterfront, other issues you want to cover here, Roger, and then take phone calls because they take us in some wild card directions. But you're always honest about what states you thought he was really going to win, what states you thought he was going to lose. off record with me, you were always really accurate. You've told me that you think it's really a dead heat, despite all their fake polling. Some polls show he's ahead. Where is Trump really right now? How is he doing? What is it, 76 days out, 77 days? How many days out?
We're around 80, I guess. Look, he's woefully underfunded, but he's still the best communicator in the country. He does these rallies, and he's pulling 30, 25, 30,000 people. She's doing rallies. She gets 171 people. They got to rearrange the cameras to try to make the crowds look bigger. There's no enthusiasm for her campaign. She was probably doing a pretty good job of bringing the progressives and liberals back in until WikiLeaks, to their credit, leaked to the entire record of her theft of Bernie Sanders. And I think that has cut off the progressive piece. That's why I think it's important that progressives have additional choices.
Sure. What do you make of the LA Times saying that he is in a dead heat with her right now?
Yeah, very, very, very telling. It's impossible to say. And by the way, we have a very volatile electorate. But based on anecdotal evidence and the enthusiasm you see around his candidacy and the lack of enthusiasm, it's not reasonable to believe that he may be running roughly even with her, perhaps a few points behind. By the way, at this juncture, I'd rather be behind than ahead.
Now, explain that, because they have these top professors. In fact, this particular one was Algorithm, where he's done five elections, always been accurate, and whoever is ahead now, for some reason, always loses. Explain that to people. Plus, all the big bot companies, the advertising companies that are so dead on accurate, Amazon can package your product before you even decide to buy it with these bots. They're saying the bots show Trump landslide.
Yeah, it's interesting. First of all, I think it's important to note that Governor Ronald Reagan trailed Jimmy Carter until the final week in the polls and pulled ahead. The debates were an important part of that. The debates are king. The debates are absolutely key, because it's an opportunity for Trump to present the real Trump and to put away the caricatures that have been drawn by the mainstream media. Secondarily, the WikiLeaks are going to be, I think, very determinative. It is absolutely clear now that those emails that the Clinton henchwomen, Huma Abedin, who's getting some bad press today, and Cheryl Mills thought they deleted, aren't deleted at all. That WikiLeaks has them, most likely the Russians have them, the Chinese have them.
And I know you've got some good contacts.
The Israelis have them, the Saudis have them. So there are multiple sources from which they could be leaked.
What's in them?
Well, the Clintons have always said, in terms of the Clinton Foundation, not their defense has always been not, we didn't do it. Their defense has been, you have no proof. Well, perhaps now we do have the proof. Perhaps now we do have the smoking gun. So, for example, when a Russian consortium gave big bucks to the Clinton Foundation in return for cornering the market on uranium production, the Clintons' position was, well, you can't prove there was a quid pro quo. Well, maybe now we can. Or let's take the Ukraine, because it's a good segue. Viktor Pinchuk, who gave $10 million to the Clinton Foundation, and in return, he got the State Department's support for toppling a Democratic elected president in Ukraine.
Outrageous.
He wasn't impeached. He wasn't beaten in a fair election. He was physically removed.
Meanwhile, Manafort is bad because he simply supported earlier in Ukraine a general election, which he's worked all over the world.
Yeah, no, he did two parliamentary elections. And then a presidential election, building the party state through three cycles. Let me tell you something, as a political consultant, you try electing a guy named Kozanowski to the parliament in Ukraine in a district that has more cows than people. This is not glamorous work. He never worked for the Ukrainian government. He never worked for the Russian government. He is not required to file anything in Washington because he didn't lobby anybody in Washington. The whole thing is a canard. But to the extent that there is Ukrainian influence in this election, yes, indeed. Viktor Pinchuk purchased the State Department's approval of a toppling of a Democratic.
Everything Hillary
president.
Accuses Trump of, she's doing.
And let me say one other thing, and I think this is crucial. Hillary's spokesman specifically denied that she had ever met with or spoken with the billionaire Ukrainian Viktor Pinchuk. We now know through the leaked emails that she met with him on at least three occasions.
She is excuse my French and Christian stations, I love God. But she is a GD liar.
And we specifically know that he dined with her at her home in Georgetown. So much for the notion that she had nothing to do with Pinchuk. Pinchuk is the one who paid for the hit job on Manafort. The so-called ledger.
No, you told me 3 months ago, you said they got PIs all over. They got this Pinchuk guy. It's all BS, but it doesn't matter because the New York Times, owned by the Mexican kingpin of kingpins, the number one funder of Hillary,
puts it on page one above the fold.
But see, that's the paradox. The New York Times is now a joke, even with liberals.
And this fellow McIntyre, I think it's Glenn McIntyre, one of the authors of that piece, admits, well, Manafort may have done nothing wrong. That's extraordinary. This was a hit piece without foundation. It's yellow journalism.
How dare Manafort, though, who, this is his business, your business, go around the world and be part of Democratic elections?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, he went and got somebody elected, and then all Hillary did was get $5 billion of State Department money with George Soros and go run around shooting police and causing riots, same thing Soros was doing here, and causing a destabilization and overthrow the government. Oh, that's so sweet. That's so nice.
Yeah, no, it's extraordinary. And I guess here is the real irony is, to the extent that there's been Ukrainian interference in our elections, it's by the Clintonites. I mean, this
story... The Clintons are using Ukrainians to interfere. Their whole foundation is a multinational takeover of America. Speak of the devil. We've been complaining for almost 3 weeks, David Knight and I, that no coverage in the U.S. press other than the real media like InfoWars and Drudge and, you know, WorldNet Daily and places like that, Breitbart, no coverage of George Soros, the Nazi collaborator, who's overthrown scores of governments, crash economies. But the Jerusalem Post and even some European press, our world, Soros' campaign of global chaos. So when you're getting attacked, this is him, as you know.
Yes, indeed.
The first thing that we see is a megalomaniacal nature of Soros' philanthropic project. No corner of the globe is unaffected by his efforts. No policy area is left untouched. And the article goes on to admit he is like the return of Hitler. So thank God somebody's looking at these emails. And so there's that thing. They can cover this up, but not forever.
Well, and George Soros is the major funder of the front group Media Matters for America and Correct the Record, which should be called Distort the Record. And all they do is attack us personally because they cannot refute our arguments. Yeah, he is the enemy, and that's who must be defeated.
But when the Jerusalem Post is coming out against Soros, I mean, The world, from the Russians to our own intelligence agencies to the Israelis now, he better be watching it.
Well, they know...
MI6 doesn't like him?
No, they know he was a Nazi collaborator historically. He's certainly no friend of the Jewish people, so I'm delighted to see the Jerusalem Post...
I think this is a bellwether that he's pretty much done.
Well, we shall see. This is going to be a horrific fight because they have the mainstream media on their side, and all we have is the American people. And Donald Trump's abilities as a communicator.
Roger Stone's our guest. It is so despicable that he gets no big pharma money, no big bank money, no big globalist money, no Monsanto money. He's preaching classic populism. They just distort what he says. Then when he comes out and gives these loving speeches about immigrants, they say it's a flip-flop when they cut the other part from the speeches a year ago out to deceive everybody.
Yes.
I mean, they are just incredible. And then, meanwhile, a Nazi collaborator runs their movement. You can't make this up. Every liberal, every progressive, every person that doesn't like corrupt elements of Wall Street should be on their knees supporting Donald Trump.
You would think so.
I mean, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah, no, to cop a phrase, it's laughable. But they're hysterical because they're in trouble, and they know they're in trouble.
Oh, yeah, because let me tell you, the leaks aren't going to stop on Soros and everybody else. And let me give you a little newsflash. Only a part of this is the Russians. Our own agencies are finally awake, and they're going to turn against these criminals. Game over, scumbags. By the way, the White House is calling for C-SPAN. I mean, they do it through Media Matters, but that's who they meet with weekly, to ban Roger Stone and then not re-air when he was on C-SPAN earlier last week in New York. That's how scared they are. If you just type in Roger Stone C-SPAN into Google, the top link comes up. In fact, I'll just show TV viewers. This way right here with the document cam. You just type in Roger Stone C-SPAN, and then you will get the top link, Roger Stone, and it'll take you right to the interview that they do not want you to see. And you can see him in 99, in 88, and in 95. There's a bunch of them, but here is his Roger Stone on Donald Trump's 2016 campaign. That's last year, and then you've got August 18th last week, Newsmakers with Roger Stone. Now, for me, what is a big deal here is that in America, The White House-run Media Matters, who got him banned off all these other channels, says banning. And now they're saying ban Breitbart and Drudge. Again, a lot of morons who are libertarians or conservatives, there's not many of them, but I hear them saying, well, that's fine. Our websites will get bigger once you're gone. That's not how this works. As we get bigger, you get bigger. People always say, we need to work with the system. We need to, like, conform and then compromise. No, the globalists never compromise with us. Trump is a movement. Trump is an insurrectionist against the globalist. We are trying to educate people, not go with the establishment brainwashing so Democrats vote for him. We're here to get you off the plantation. We're here to try to shake you out of your coma. And that's why they're coming and saying, shut down our speech in America. That's an indictment of the system. That's why everyone should vote Donald Trump, but also go to InfoWarsStore.com and get a Bill Clinton rape shirt. Get a Hillary for prison shirt. 20% off on Living Defense Parasite Cleanse. A bunch of other specials. The film Amerageddon, exclusively available. You can get my films free when you get a second copy. InfoWarsStore.com. We need you to spread the word. We need you to financially support us. We need you to get his books at InfoWarsStore.com. We need you to promote us because we're in a 21st century modern war with high-tech globalists, but we have HUMET and the individual human spirit. And when you take action and realize, just like electricity, you know, getting a circuit and passing through, when you take action, that's what sends the thunderbolts and lightning bolts down the line straight into Hillary's big fat diaper ass.
I got to say this. The schedule that I'm keeping, Alex, I got to tell you, I could not do without popping a couple brain forces when I get up in the morning. Brain force keeps you moving. Now, they'll attack us for this, too, because we believe in alternative medicine, because we believe, as been done for centuries, that herbs and supplements work. That makes us kooky. There's something nutty about us. This product works. I use it every day. I could not keep the schedule that I keep working for freedom, working for Donald Trump, if I didn't have brain force.
Until the Germans came out with synthetic drugs 160 years ago or so, apothecaries were the drugstore. He had doctors there and apothecaries, but everything was herbs or natural compounds.
Chinese medicine is 3,000 years old. Western medicine is roughly 150 years old. Please, give me a break.
Exactly.
But they'll depict us as kooky because we believe in alternatives to Western medicine. So, look, brain force is a great product.
We came up with the best nootropic we could for a low price. I mean, it really is good. I appreciate your plug. And that's how we're funding ourselves. Roger selling books, you know, myself selling Hillary for president shirts. But beyond that, it's not about that. We're in a total war. Roger.
Absolutely.
Let me make a little guess. You could have easily over the years been hired by the other side.
Oh, I've had offers. They've tried to buy me off. The Russians themselves actually approached me when I was working for Reagan, and they told me they could really enhance my lifestyle if I would just go to work for them. You know what I did? I took it right to the FBI. No, I could easily have switched sides. George Bush tried to hire me for his 1988 campaign. Not interested. So, look, I think we're...
Because the real value is being genuine.
Well, I came to believe certain things. For a lot of times, I was kind of a blind, right-of-center, mainstream Republican. And then I began to see the criminality of the Bushes, the lies that got us into the Iraq War. It was time to become a whistleblower.
You've been exposing him for about 14 years. We'll be back with Roger Stone in just a few minutes on your phone calls and Paul Watson from London, England. This is a war. Buy your war bonds, InfoWarsStore.com. More importantly, spread the word about the broadcast. I haven't seen the C-SPAN interview he did from New York last week that the White House wants banned. And I can't believe that, but that's what Media Matters is when they want to ban them.
Yes.
On their site, they say it. And it's right here, Newsmakers with Roger Stone. And you're on for 30 minutes. And I asked, what did you cover? And, of course, it was election fraud.
Yeah, no, this whole narrative drives them crazy because it's true. So I cited the Stanford study. I cite the Princeton professor, Dr. Fetrakis, the Ohio professor. And I made a comprehensive case. It was a very contentious interview. Monica Langley of the Wall Street Journal was on. She was perfectly fair, but she gave as good as she got. But you see, they can't stand alternative ideas. They can't stand anybody else's narrative. Liberals love free speech as long as it's their free speech.
So they've been running a monopoly for a long time. They've just now figured out no one's listening to them. And so now they want to shut us down.
Exactly. Exactly. But I think we're winning. Let me give you an example. I wrote for Breitbart over a month ago two what I believe to be seminal pieces on Huma Abedin, connecting her to the World Muslim League, connecting her to the Institute for Minority Muslim Affairs.
And now it's the biggest story in the country.
Exactly. Finally, a month later, you have mainstream media outlets, some of them beginning to cover
this. Well, Roger, issue. The media calls you this evil, nasty, galactic super liar, and then you're like the most accurate person I probably ever had on air.
Well, I appreciate that.
No, I'm
that.
Serious, though. Well, I guess that's just an inversion of reality.
It's character assassination. They attack me because they're afraid of me. You know, you can call me anything you want. The only title I really prefer is effective. I like to be effective on behalf of my ideals, my candidates, and my principles. And I think I'm being attacked because I have been.
Well, it's incredible. She openly writes for a journal that says suppress Muslim women. She's openly hooked into these Islamic, jihadi groups. She's got classified material in the front of her car. Everything you said about her, as best we can tell, what, she's a Saudi royal agent?
I think she's a Saudi asset. Look, the media keeps saying her mother's a prominent feminist. No, her mother's a prominent advocate for genital mutilation. She has written extensively
that's a question.
About genital mutilation.
Did Uma have her genitals cut off?
That I cannot tell you. But what I can tell you is...
I mean, it's fair. I don't mean that to be crass.
She worked for an organ that blamed the United States for the attack on 9/11. She was working for a journalist that said that editorially. Where does she come from? How does she show up in Washington and tell the Washingtonian years before she's even met the Clintons that she has a handbag for every day of the week and each handbag is $1,500? Her parents are poor academics back in Saudi Arabia.
She says she's got all the trappings of an agent.
Exactly. The wealth, she dresses the part. Where's this money coming from? Now, once she met the Clintons and she got an unprecedented... a deal where she has a threefer. She has a special waiver that allowed her to make money as a full-time employee of the State Department while she was double-dipping at the Clinton Foundation and triple-dipping at Teneo.
But then
Strategy.
You're also not supposed to criticize Chelsea, Webster Hubble's daughter, because she gets $6 million money laundering.
$6 million a year to run the money laundering operation of the Clinton Foundation. Poor Chelsea says she tried to care about money. She just can't. If I lived in a $10.5 million apartment in Manhattan, New York, I probably wouldn't care about money either.
Oh, that poor baby. A $10 million apartment.
And a lot those plastic surgeries, they're very expensive. So you got to
feel
sorry.
She still looks like Mr. Ed. I'm not trying to be mean. But
no, she looks like her father, Webster Hubble.
Who looks like a cartoon.
Mr. Ed, yes. Good point.
Now, expanding, she's the daughter of Mr. Ed.
She's the daughter of Webster Hubble, the former law partner of Hillary Clinton.
So a horse is a horse, of course, of course.
The former deputy attorney general, the guy who Hillary called to say, launch the assault at Waco, as I establish in my book, both Senator Arlen Specter's investigation in the U.S. Senate and T. March Bell, the chief investigator for the House Committee on Waco, both concluded Hillary gave the order. Co-president Hillary gave the order that killed
18
children.
Well, I got to say, I hadn't even thought of you whenever you talked about Uma Abedin, but that's all come out to be documented. You first broke that, and you also talked about watch the watchers, watch who the Justice Department sends in, and now they're hiring 10 times more UN run. Does that make you sleep good at night?
You know, here's an irony that has occurred to me, and that is they accuse us of being conspiracy theorists when they are the ones who say that Donald Trump is a traitor to his
Stay right there. All right, we're riding a shotgun with Paul Watson and taking phone calls, at least for the first 30 minutes, and Watson will be taking over. Paul, don't run away. We're about to go right to you, my friend. But Roger Stone is my guest here in studio. He's been in Dallas speaking to a capacity crowd at a book signing. He was just on C-SPAN last week, and the White House is trying to censor that. I mean, it's otherworldly when you go to Media Matters, again, run by the White House on record, and they're saying, don't have Roger Stone on MSNBC. Don't have Roger Stone on CNN. And they say on air one day later, Roger Stone is now banned. And then we know they say he should be banned on Fox, and he hadn't been on since then. And then they come out and say, conservative media that's independent has no right to exist. We're going to start with Breitbart. In fact, did we ever play that clip? Did we find that clip of Drudge saying a year ago when he came here, they're coming after the press? Let's cue that up in a moment, and then we're going to go to calls. But Paul Watson, when you hosted the show last week, I think it was Friday, you really hammered this, and I keep going back to this. I mean, everyone should be against the Democrats right now. I didn't like Bush because of his police state garbage. But just like Jonathan Turley, the liberal constitutional law professor said Obama's been 3 times worse. That was a few years ago. How about 10 times worse now? Because if they were arresting Michael Moore for his movie like they did Dinesh D'Souza, I would stand up for Michael Moore. I mean, I'm not a Republican or a Democrat. I'm a libertarian patriot. But, man, I got to tell you, the Democrats are so corrupt now, Paul, and so open about their corruption. Is this a disconnect? I think more and more it is a disconnect. Or what do they know we don't know? I mean, why didn't Obama show up for 6 days to New Orleans when they criticized Bush for doing that? Or why didn't Hillary even show up? I mean, it just seems like almost entertaining if it wasn't so real. Paul Watson, what do you think's happening?
Well, I think they're authoritarians now. They're coming out in the open with it, Alex. I mean, we've got Google, and we know this. We knew this back in June that they were already hiding certain search results for Hillary Clinton. When you type in Hillary Clinton CRI, Hillary Clinton crimes don't come up. It's something about Hillary Clinton, you know, CRI, whatever. You type in Hillary Clinton IND for indictment, it comes up Hillary Clinton India. And now we had the article yesterday, Google hides Clinton body count search suggestions. You go on any other search engine, Bing, Yahoo search, whatever, you type in Clinton body, and then immediately a list of information links about the Clinton body count comes up. You do it on google.com,
it doesn't happen.
What you get is Clinton body shop, these obscure auto repair shops in, you know, Midwestern America or whatever. Nothing whatsoever, no search suggestion for Clinton body count.
And in a digital world, they can disappear you anytime they want. This is unprecedented. Paul, how could any real liberal, in the classic Thomas Jefferson sense, how could they not openly support Trump at this point? This is such an endorsement of him. The fact he gets no big money. This is what we've been waiting for, Paul.
It's because they do absolutely no research. They do no reading. They swallow what they're fed by the mainstream media.
I mean, they're just fake intellectual fops with fake color socks walking around saying how intellectual they are, right?
Yeah, and they're taught this inevitability that Hillary Clinton's going to win. Well, you look at the polls, you look at the Bloomberg poll, the Reuters poll, they've got a system where they go in and say, they take people who say they're not voting for either Trump or Clinton, then they pressure them and say, well, who would you vote for if you did vote for someone? Would it be Clinton? Would it be Hillary? Would it be Hillary? So then they add the people in who say they're not going to vote in the Clinton bracket. That's why she's winning all these polls. They also go in and change, they manipulate, they amend the results. They weigh the sample in favor of Democrats. So they oversample Democrats in these polls again and again and again. So, of course, Hillary Clinton is going to come out on top. When you get a more even sampling of Republicans and Democrats, then normally Trump comes out on top. So they're faking, they're rigging these polls to make it seem like Hillary Clinton is inevitable to take the White House. Even with that, you've got a UPI poll out today which shows there's 1 point in it. So even though they're rigging the polls for Hillary, Trump is still on an even keel.
And LA Times has got a scientific poll that shows him ahead by a point. I want to go to phone calls. Right, shotgun, Paul. Jump at any time. You know, this is a three hosts here in the callers. But Roger Stone, you're chomping at the bit.
Well, what Paul says is absolutely true. Look, I have an ego. I looked myself up on Google on the way here. The first 7 stories are all manufactured by the Clinton thugs. All the negative stuff is at the top. All the positive stuff that I've done here. All of the free expression stuff we've done, it's all moved to the bottom. Yeah, it's an entirely rigged system. We live now with a fake reality of rigged polls and rigged elections.
These people are incredible authoritarians. But I'll tell you, this only makes me double down and know I've always been right and that I'm never going to give up, Roger. What does it do for you? I mean, we really now know our worst fears were accurate. I just got chills.
No, I think that's...
Holy terror, these people.
That's absolutely right. Paul did a terrific piece on Hillary's health. Yesterday, I was asked by Fernando Amandi, who's a terrific and incredibly fair but Democratic talk show host in Miami, would I be satisfied if the Clintons just released a letter from her doctor and her medical records? I reminded him that Dr. Janet Travell, The doctor for President John F. Kennedy released a letter saying he did not have Addison's just before the election, putting the health questions that Lyndon Johnson had been spreading to bed. Later, when we saw his autopsy, we learned that he was in the latter stages of Addison's disease. No, nothing the Clintons say about her health will be true.
Well, let me ask you falsified. This then. From all the good sources, now we have WikiLeaks that she was trying to get Parkinson's medication and that she, quote, couldn't get up if she laid down and, quote, was falling down and, quote, all these neurologists are going, look, I'm a Democrat, but this woman's got problems.
She had decision fatigue.
What is the best thinking in your own intel on what's really wrong with her?
Look, I have no anything beyond my own observations. The real question would be, what happens if she kicks the bucket before the election, which looks to me to be entirely possible? Do they go to Uncle Joe Biden, who can't seem to keep his hands off of Hillary and any woman that he meets, and particularly younger girls? Or do we give the nomination to Senator Kaine, who seems to be the hand-picked successor? This guy's got to be licking his chops. He sees her. He's got to see she's on her last legs. He's looking at becoming president by default, by riding in with her. So the whole question of her health is a perfectly legitimate issue that they just don't want to confront. So they have to call us names.
What about the stupid pickle thing? Clearly, the pickle top doesn't pop off. She just turns it. Have you seen the stupid
Yeah, what does this prove? Let her run a 10K, and then I'll believe she's in good health. All right, a 5K.
I got four containers of pickles in here, and one of them was so tight I was having trouble getting it off. I mean, this woman
You
is
obviously
so...
shouldn't be president then.
Absolutely.
That makes it clear.
I need a knife to be hitting the top of it. I want to take a few phone calls here. We're skipping this network break. Andrea, we're going to go to you in a moment. John in California. We're going to go to Chris. We're going to go to Owl Killer and Anthony. We've got Chris is a black American upset with Alex Jones. And that sounds like an interesting phone call. But I'm going to go to Andrea first in the great state of Texas, since she's kind of on the general topic. Go ahead, Andrea. You're on the air with Roger Stone and Paul Watson.
Hello, Alex. Nice to say hi to you again.
You bet. Thank
you
for calling.
I've been on your show before, and I hope you still remember me. I was the mother that spoke about Monsanto and the kids with autism.
Absolutely. I remember your call. That was a while ago.
Okay. Well, I want people to know also that I'm a Latin American citizen. So my background is Hispanic. And I'm a middle upper class, of course. I'm a hardworking person, and I support Donald Trump. So when the Democrats are saying that Donald Trump doesn't have a Latino support, is a utterly bullshit. Everybody here in Houston area, Galveston area, that are middle class Latinos, Hispanic, that have jobs, that hire people. We support Donald Trump because we are majority Republicans. We also believe in, as a libertarians, we believe in the hardworking, not in the handout. And,
well, sure. I mean, if you look at communism and socialism, it's not compatible with the great work ethic I've seen from people that are south of the United States on average. I don't want to be clichéd, but I mean, it's been observed. But if you look at this, what are the hidden numbers of people that have been bullied into being closeted Trump supporters? I mean, a lot of people called me, in fact, mainstream media, I probably had, let's not exaggerate, more than 15 newspapers call my cell phone that just know it in the last week going, oh, your guy's flip-flopping on immigration. How do you feel? And I remember his full clips a year ago that I played, and I want to speak to this right now with Roger Stone and Paul Watson, where he'd say, I love people. I love people from all over the country, all over the world. We need you. But if you're a felon and you're coming here to get stuff free and you're doing all this, blah, 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 you know, we're going to deport you, blah, blah, blah. Well, they just cut it to we're going to deport you, and that turned into I hate Mexicans. They're all criminals. And now they're saying he flip-flopped. He always said, I hire a lot of immigrants. They're great people. We're going to make sure you're good. We're going to make sure you're vetted. We're going to make it quick. We're going to make it simple, but you're going to be vetted. That's not flip-flopping. That's not. We've got 35 or 40 million people here, most of them felons, doing whatever they want. And we're just now going to just flip a switch and say you're all legal and screw all the people that came here legally. Trump's going to make it easier to come here legally. That's what we need. We need good people here. We killed most of our kids in America, no matter what color we were. We made that decision. Good. Bring them in from Latin America. Don't bring them in from Sunni countries. I'm done. Go ahead.
I think that's exactly right. We saw the same thing when Trump said he favored a temporary ban on Muslim immigration on CNN. That became a ban on Muslim immigration. And then, of course, several of the Republican candidates come out and said, well, that's unconstitutional, which it most definitely is not. So it's the same smear tactic. Donald Trump has not changed his position.
He didn't flip-flop. They're now just showing the full quote.
And the fact that Trump insists that the Immigration Service should be allowed to look at the social media postings of those who apply to come here. No, if you're saying on your Facebook page...
They look at my social media when I fly in.
So if they want, if someone is saying on their Facebook page, Ali Akbar, death to all the Jews, I don't want that person in the United States. And neither does Donald Trump.
Let me ask Paul Watson that question since you brought that up. Look, I've got issues with Israel, but there's this idiotic thing like I have issues with America. I have issues with the cops. I mean, I want to shoot them in the back of the head. It's a diverse situation. Soros emails come out where he wants to overthrow the U.S., overthrow Europe, overthrow Israel for the Muslims. And this is the whole liberal cause celeb. Regardless of what you think about stuff happening in Israel, there's bad problems on both sides. Israel's got seven or eight parties. It's a diverse group of people. And now, even the Jerusalem Post comes out and says, our world, Soros campaign of global chaos, the fact that his emails are coming out, even the Jerusalem Post is calling him a dangerous megalomaniac who thinks he's God. Soros said in interviews he believes he's the Messiah. What the hell is this crazy Nazi collaborator doing? Paul Watson, do you think Soros has gone too far? I mean, is he like milk that finally got rotten in the grocery store cooler? I mean, does this guy just go on forever?
Well, I mean, he's definitely one of the biggest skeletons in Hillary's closet. The media didn't touch those leaked emails. They didn't touch them. They haven't talked about them. There are explosive revelations in there, I think, that are yet to be revealed. With the ideological test, the immigration thing, you know, Trump came out and said, we want people here who respect LGBT rights, respect women, respect gays. You would think that the left would be cheering and celebrating that. Well, no. Sally Cohn of CNN says that Sharia law is progressive. Now, you look at the characteristics of Sharia law, Alex. Wife beating.
Cut women's genitals off. Kill gays.
Child marriage. You know, female genital mutilation. That's progressive, according to the left. Because, again, they're not liberals. They're regressive leftists. They're authoritarians.
And why are they in love with the most radical Sunni weirdos?
Well, because they share the same end goal, which is the complete destruction of America. I've said that over and over again.
But you look, and we now have the emails that that's what Soros is planning. And you say is her biggest biggest skeleton in the closet. He's running things. These emails show no one more than Soros is quarterbacking things. He's the first string quarterback.
No, they show you can look at the Black Lives Matter funding and it says directly, this is to destroy the current system as it stands. And this is, you know, what the agenda's been all along with political correctness, with Marxism, is to overthrow the entire system. And that's what it says in the Black Lives Matter Soros documents. That's why he's funding Black Lives Matter. That's why the mainstream media is encouraging these riots. But you can even look at the polls with the immigration issue. 6 out of 10 immigrants support Donald Trump's ideological test. So to say it's racist and bigoted, again, they can't sell that anymore because the polls have completely disproven them. But Sharia law is progressive now, chopping people's hands off, beating women, that's progressive according to the
way. This is insane, and then they call us bigots. Andrea in Texas, other comments. How many other Latino people that you talk to, just on average, dead reckoning, are really supportive of Trump but scared to say it? Or what percentage of Latinos do you think really support Trump?
It's a huge number, Alex, but they keep it to themselves because there is a lot of bully also going on. But what is amazing is that everybody I ask, even in California, because I'm originally from California, and all my family's friends, people that work for big companies, everybody that is a Latin American citizen, which we should make a difference between the people outside making riots and stuff. Those are illegals that they don't even vote, so it's irrelevant. You can see 100 or 200 of them is irrelevant. They don't vote unless they do fraud. But the legal Americans, Hispanic background, they are supporting Trump because we are sick and tired of the Democrats taxing us to the sky to bring people that are unskilled people, unvetted people, like the Muslims, like from all over the world.
And absolutely. So, in fact, I want to point out, everybody obsesses on Mexicans all day. That used to be the biggest group. For like 3 years, it's Chinese women are the biggest group. And they come here to have their babies for free. I'm not against Asians. My sister's adopted from Korea. I love Asians. The point is, I can't go to China and have babies for free. I mean, we're going bankrupt. This is insane. And it's a plan, and the globalists are doing it to drive down our wages. We want hardworking people with no criminal records. America needs immigrants. And Trump has always said that. Trump has always been for that, Roger.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. On the way here from Dallas, I returned a call from a Washington Post reporter who said that Trump yesterday had made a blatant appeal for African-American votes. And how did I square that with his past as a racist? That was the question. So, I mean, the point here is...
The guy's known to be a massive hire of African-Americans.
Well, not only that, but it was Bill Clinton who passed the 1994 crime bill, which has incarcerated an entire generation of young black men for nonviolent crime,
such as
the possession of small amounts of drugs. And in the Clinton bill, the penalties for rock cocaine are much more harsh than the penalties for powdered
cocaine. That'd be like new stereotypical. That'd be like the five times more for malt liquor than Bud Light.
So in this particular case,
because whites drink Bud Light on average, blacks will drink malt liquor.
Yes.
Yeah, it's so, the same. It's incredible.
And as you know, Hillary Clinton said that the 1994 bill, which has destroyed an entire generation of young black men, was necessary because blacks...
By the way, I drink malt liquor.
Super predators who must be brought to heel.
By the way, I like malt liquor over regular beer.
I do, too.
That's why we're racist.
We're racist, obviously.
I like fried chicken, too.
I do, too, but that doesn't make us racist.
No, but I would see these things like, they're racist, they serve fried chicken. Like, Clinton is a racist, or at least a race pimp.
He's the one who went to federal court to argue for racial profiling.
No, but the media called him racist when he served black people chicken. That's not racist. Everybody likes chicken.
Yeah, let's just remember, it was Bill Clinton who said to Ted Kennedy about Barack Obama, you know, Ted, a few years ago, this boy would be fetching our coffee. There's your dog whistle politics right there.
I know. I'm going to be honest, because I grew up in a Republican family of, like, Christians who were all beat ourselves in the back for being evil racist, and America has to atone. It was like the Republicans were the original kind of liberal, political correct people. But then I would get around Democrats, and it was once I got political, and these people are racist. And I mean, including black people. It's like racist against black people. And I've had black leaders on, they go, oh, you didn't know that?
Oh, yeah, it's completely phony. Look, every landmark civil rights bill in the 60s passed only with the votes of Republicans because the Southern Democrats wouldn't vote for them.
Lincoln a Democrat?
Lincoln was a Republican, but the Democrats are the party of the Klan.
No. He was a Democrat.
Yeah, well, I'm a conspiracy realist. They are the racists.
Doesn't matter. I'm going to call a conspiracy theorist. He was a Democrat.
Dinesh D'Souza's movie covers this very, very well. It is one of the best things in the movie, is the history of the Democratic Party and racism. They're the party of the racists.
But they really are.
We're the party of civil rights.
But they really are.
That is our birthright. Now, we may have wandered from it, but it's time to get back to it. You know what black people want? The black people I talk to, and I talk to quite a few, you know what they want? They want a job. They want a piece of the American pie. They don't want to be employees. They want to be employers. They want to move up the ladder. That's not happened under Bill Clinton. It's not happened under Barack Obama.
And they want the criminals in their neighborhood arrested, not tolerated.
Well, because black-on-black crime is their worst problem. No, so I think Trump is the candidate of black opportunity. Trump is the candidate of black capitalism. That's why...
By the way, he's really into prosperity. Obama isn't saying, elect me, black people, I'm going to help you. Trump is directly saying that.
What has employment among black people done under Barack Obama? It's abysmal. And as you know, they deduct the people who have stopped working, looking for work,
the roles,
from the count to make it look better. And it still stinks.
Absolutely. Andrea, we're going to continue on. Paul Watson, we're going to ride shotgun a bit with you. Paul comes in and does the show twice a week. We should do it more. He's so popular. But then sometimes I go, right over. You don't mind if we continue on with you, do you, Paul?
No, go ahead.
We're pirates. We've taken over. In fact, you're battling the redcoats, battling the bluecoats right now.
It's a hijacking.
The other thing, Alex, on Trump with black people, he's going to get the most votes for a Republican candidate from black people ever, by the looks of it. You look at pictures of Trump, almost every other picture is him with black public figures, hugging them, smiling with them. Why did Trump only become a racist when he became a Republican? I mean, this is a meme. His entire history is being friends with black people, hiring African-Americans.
Listen, the right-wing Christians actually have a point on the whole advocate for gay people. But my issue is the media inverts it. He's anti-gay.
Which is absurd because he's the only one who will protect gays and lesbians from radical Islamic maniacs who want to kill them.
And 30 years ago, he was doing interviews with The Advocate. So, saying they deserve equal rights.
Yes, indeed.
That's why he's anti-gay, just like he's anti-black.
It's absurd.
Just like he's anti-immigrant. No, he's anti-serial killers that have been deported four times, coming back and shooting a young woman in San Francisco. He ran into some fans, even in the control room. Richard Reeves and his wife here did a great job on the Trump campaign. I tell you, what an incredible time. The way Trump defeated, the way you defeated, the way we defeated the attempt to steal the nomination from Trump, that is so historical. That is a major war. That is history book stuff we're in. But the enemy media is not going to tell you that happened. They're not going to tell you how big that was. And now that Trump is fighting it again, and the fact that they're like, oh, there's no such thing as election fraud. What's that? Meanwhile, the Justice Department is hiring five times the people to poll watch. The UN is sending in with the EU 10 times. That's Reuters. This sounds scary. The fact that international observers, the EU, the UN, the EU won't even let you have an election, you know, with their system. The fact that all this is happening, Roger, is huge.
This is why the exit polls will be so crucial, because it'll be, oh, the only tool we have to demonstrate and prove the steal. Because you're going to have these UN inspectors saying, oh, everything was on the up and up. Well, I'm sorry. If the results of the machine are different than the exit polls.
Nico, come on in and fix this. It's no big deal. We're on TV, too. Radio listeners, Infowars.com/show to watch the free video feed. Some stations carry it. But no, this is the great part about teleprompter free. We're live. Set this up. I'll talk to Paul about this and take calls. How do we counter this? How do we have poll watchers effectively in battleground states? What do we do? Lay it out.
No, we have to organize scientifically conducted exit polls in very carefully selected precincts and then you need to compare those to the machines. The other great thing is to demand to see the software that programs the machines by a third party, somebody who's truly independent and honest and trustworthy, to determine that the machines have not been easily fixed before the fact. This can be done quite simply. Dr. Fetrakis has persuaded me of this. Those are two reasonable things that must be done. Now, if we want good, viable, accurate exit poll, we're going to have to do it ourselves. But then you will have stone-cold evidence of the steal. By the way, my new site, stonecoldtruth.com, which is going to be taking the place of stonezone.com, we have a number of stories up about election fraud, and other mainstream sources have demonstrated how easily these machines can be hacked.
Okay, so now I say stonecoldtruth.com.
That's correct. Yep.
Not stonezone.com. Paul Watson, jump in here. We're going to take some phone calls and turn the situation over to you. We got Chris, a black American, upset with Alex Jones, owl killers, active military police on Trump and sealing, I guess, the border. Anthony, union efforts to demonize Trump. John wants to talk Roger Stone on Nixon. And John in Wyoming wants to talk 60 Minutes interview. We're going to go to those in just a minute. But Paul, jumping in.
Well, I wanted to raise one more thing on Hillary's health. Of course, as we predicted for years now, they're coming out and saying that any discussion of this is sexist. That didn't stop the mainstream media you know, obsessing about John McCain's health back in 2008.
Oh, yeah, I hate Hillary because she's a woman. I love women.
Again, absolutely pathetic. Now their main line of attack, Alex, CNN did a big hit piece on us last night. You probably don't even know about it yet.
I don't even watch that channel.
And neither does anyone else.
I get attacked like 10 times a week by mainstream TV. I don't even watch it now. No, I'm sorry. Tell me, Paul, tell me what they did.
They came out, they showed our articles without, of course, mentioning us by name, but they showed InfoWars articles. They said that the Hillary health issue has been debunked, and their sources for their evidence, their proof for it being debunked, was Hillary Clinton says she's fine. In 2014, Bill Clinton said that Hillary was fine, and Hillary's own internist personal physician says that she's fine. So you have three amazingly impartial, independent sources there. Hillary's internist, Bill Clinton, and Hillary herself. That was their evidence for saying that the whole controversy had been debunked.
Well, it turns out...
Wait, you see that internist becomes the White House physician, which is, of course, a very coveted position. So it's easy to get them to lie.
But that particular person was her private physician in New York and didn't treat her during the brain surgeries and the year in the hospital. That's not the real medical record. Sorry, go ahead.
No, and as I pointed out, John Kennedy's doctor falsified his record. She was later rewarded with the position, and she was New York-based. Dr. Janet Travell was rewarded with the position of White House physician in return for her lie about covering up his Addison's disease.
It's incredible. They even covered up that he'd broken his back in that PT boat attack on the battleship.
Look, I'll tell you what, the one thing that has become the byproduct of these attacks on us, the death threats against me and my family are really up. I've gotten three, and it's only Tuesday this week, and they're all the same. The Clintons have killed many people who've gotten in their way. You're next. That's the one I read on the way here. They always come from email addresses I can't identify, and when you try to trace them, they're untraceable. I'm really getting fed up with this, frankly. It upsets my wife. It upsets my family. And I'm not going to stop. No number of death threats is going to stop.
Let me raise this, because I raised this last week. Tokyo Rose was a collection of women that would get on the radio and tell GIs, you're losing, America has fallen, like Baghdad Rob, when bombers are, you know, bombing a mile behind him in Baghdad. He says the U.S. has been kicked out of Iraq. And the Germans had their own people that would pump propaganda in. As Berlin was about to fall, they were still broadcasting that they had defeated the Allies. And so there is this level of this. And I know they've killed a lot of people. We know you're gangsters. We know you're murderers.
Thugs.
I always wonder why they tell me we can kill you or we can come after you. That's why I'm fighting you. I know you got me fired. They physically attacked me, you know, 17, 18 years ago and told me this is for the Clintons. That's why I fight harder. But it's like when Hitler started bombing England, when he couldn't get them to surrender, he thought bombing civilian targets and cities where kids had been sent to be safe would make the British back down. Instead, a lot of British didn't want the war. Once you bomb civilian centers, they wanted the war. I don't get why these psychopaths think threatening us intimidates us. That might work with the average schmo on the street. All it does is make me work 18 hours a day. Is that what you're saying, Roger Stone?
That's exactly what I'm saying. So if in the next few months they tell you that I had a brain tumor, or that I had a brain hemorrhage, or that I was killed in a hunting accident, or that I was depressed and I took my own life, go handcuff Hillary, because that's who did it. That's the only protection we have. I don't fear you. I no longer fear you.
We're all going to die. Hell, let me go out with some turd on legs taking me out, you piece of crap. God's going to get you in the end. I will never commit suicide. I love life. I'm not involved in anything that's dangerous or bad. I don't even speed anymore. And if you kill me, it's going to come out, bastards. Paul Watson, you want to talk to that?
Well, yeah, I can talk to death threats. I mean, I made a video saying that Islam's not a religion of peace, and I got about 20 death threats from people saying, we're going to prove that it is a religion of peace by killing you, if that makes any sense, which of course it doesn't. Then Black Lives Matter, I got 25 death threats within a 24-hour period because I posted an image of the guy who was shot by cops saying that he was a criminal, their new icon. Then you had, of course, Julian Assange put out tweets of Bob Beckel saying that he should be assassinated. We see this bizarre incident outside the Ecuadorian embassy where this guy tries to break in. There's a police station that's constantly watching over that embassy, 2 minutes walk away. 2 minutes walk, and it takes them 2 hours to respond.
Definitely
what
an assassin.
Going on with-
yeah.
And, hey, I told you, and of course, there's been a question by James Woods on what's the Vegas line on how long he's going to be alive. Assange needs to dump this stuff now. Go ahead.
I don't disagree with that, but anyway, you slice it. Assange is the man's a hero. He's a freedom fighter. It's interesting how the left loved him when he was leaking stuff against the Bushes, but now
he's bipartisan. He stands up for what's right.
Well, he's fighting the deep state, is what he's doing. He's fighting the police state, the two-party duopoly that's run this country.
And let's get this
and
straight.
Is running the world.
The police state ain't a cop changing your tire. It's the big guys up top.
No question about it.
Keep going.
So, from my point of view here, they are more scared than they have ever been. They're near hysterical in their attacks.
Hillary's diapers are full of it.
It has taken on a vituperative nature that I've never seen before. There aren't one or two or three articles from Media Matters attacking me in the last 24 hours. There's four. It's not going to work, folks. Nobody's buying your crap.
And we don't care what you do to us. They just, as cowards, they don't get that. When they threaten us over and over again, I always say to them, you don't understand. I know you're murderers.
Do they not understand that, first of all, we're armed and we're vigilant? We're not afraid of guns. We understand our Second Amendment rights. We're not afraid. So if you want to come, come, but I'm not sure who's going to end up dead, you or me.
And I always get emails from people.
More likely you.
Exactly. People calling up going, well, there's a two-way street in the world. I mean, people might get me, but I got a lot of family that are just good people.
Yeah, no, this is an absurdity. I'm against violence, and I made that very clear, even though they keep accusing me of being the one who is fomenting violence. Violence solves nothing, but they're the ones who resort to the death threats. I'm not threatening the Clintons, other than with exposure of the facts about their criminality.
Oh, what about when they said Trump was threatening when he said, they're going to take your guns with these judges. You may claim Second Amendment have some other option. That's nothing compared to my cold, dead hand with Heston. You know, everything that's a cliche about the Second Amendment when all others fail. Meanwhile, Hillary's on tape saying in 2008, Obama better watch it. He'll end up like Bobby Kennedy.
No, they asked her why she's staying in the race, and she says, well, you know, Bobby Kennedy got assassinated as late as June, meaning she was hoping for the assassination of Obama. Now, there's the epitome of racism.
Well, here's the deal. I don't want some physical fight with a bunch of order takers at Media Matters that just take their White House orders and put it out for the media as a fence. But you're right. Media Matters doesn't have traffic. People ask me, why do I care? Because they get the orders. It goes out to the media. They say, ban Stone. It happens. I personally got over, we never bragged about this, but over 250 affiliates a couple of years ago. We never got above about 170. A lot of them were big stations. We're still on some big stations. 50,000 watters and stuff. 100,000 watt FMs, 50,000 watt AMs that cover like five states. I had the program director, some of them I'd known for years, in places like Texas. People I've been fishing with, you know, patriots. They go, listen, I know I can tell you this off record. Just don't say the station. They're going to offer us $200,000 a month to take you off. Your show brings them like $50,000, $60,000 a month. I don't want to do this, but the owners are going to fire me if I don't. What do I do? Should I quit? I said, you know, this is happening all over the country. It's okay. Just do your job. But I said, next, you're going to start getting censored, and they're going to kick off the other real conservatives. And you know what? They did. 6 months later, they got rid of them. And then I found out all over the country, they are even micromanaging local affiliates and kicking the patriots off locally, even though they have ratings that are making money. And they'll come in and pay huge amounts of money to put another host on who spews their garbage through advertising and payola.
And what happens? And their ratings drop.
Exactly.
And the ratings for alternative conservative media go up every time.
So the problem is they force the air out of the room over here. Everybody goes to the web. Now they got to kill that.
Right. So they character assassinate Roger Ailes, who's a great patriot and a pioneer of television, and who's made them extraordinarily profitable at Fox and built a giant constituency.
Dude, if they're spending $200,000 a month to take me off one station, this is panic level.
They're going to convert the Fox to the Sky Channel in the UK. And in the United States, their ratings are going to drop and their profitability is going to drop, while their viewers at Fox are going to move elsewhere.
But they're willing to do it because they mean to take it all out.
They're going to try. But it ain't over.
What do you think about Murdoch's kids? Because we've confirmed what we already knew from sources. Because I talked to Fox execs, the same hotel you did. They said, no, off record, it's true. We're being taken over. We're going to be like CNN now. I cannot believe they're going to do this. They make $1 billion a year. But see, they make trillions running the whole show.
Well, and one of Murdoch's sons is married to a one of Bloomberg's relatives who works at the Clinton Foundation. The Murdoch sons, unlike their father, they're liberals, and they're very embarrassed when they go to the right Upper East Side New York cocktail parties and people say, oh, you own Fox? How embarrassing. No, Fox is a moneymaker. Ailes is
a
great
American. These are nobodies that have been handed everything.
Yeah, and he's been smeared here, and they've run him off because he was committed to the defeat of Hillary Clinton. That's
it. Paul, this is epic. I mean, I hired you 15 years ago. What is it like for you to see all this craziness today?
I mean, it's the hardest I've worked in any year. But with the Fox thing, they had two different segments talking about Hillary's health recently. I almost did an article on this. Three guests on one segment, two on a different segment with the two hosts. So you had a total of seven people on these two different Fox shows, not Fox Business, which is slightly different. Seven different people all agreeing with Hillary Clinton talking points on Fox News, saying that these health questions are nothing more than a conspiracy theory. Seven people on Fox News all agreeing.
And all since the coup, 1 month ago.
No, Fox News reported last Thursday that this entire health canard was cooked up by right-wing conspiracy theorist Roger Stone. They named me. It's extraordinary that Fox would even carry that. So the Clintons are calling me out.
They're writing the script.
Yeah, it's Kafka-esque. It's so weird.
I mean, the thing is, though, other countries that got taken over by really hardcore tyrannies, people were usually serfs, but the slaves weren't treated bad on average. I'm not defending slavery, but they weren't treated bad like in Russia or wherever, or Germany or wherever. And then a really crazy tyranny would come in, like the French Revolution, killing everybody, and folks would turn against it. Here we have the institutions of freedom, Second Amendment, still some awake people, with the paradox of great evil massing. So they're doing their old game plan, but with our old system still parallel. Do they realize that they're not doing this in the dark?
No, I don't think they do. It's like when at least three and perhaps four people connected to the Democratic National Committee theft of the nomination from Bernie Sanders and Hillary end up dead, and we raise that as odd and say maybe it's not coincidental. They call us conspiracy theories. Like, what we're saying isn't common sense.
And then Assange comes out and basically says, yeah, that's my source. They murdered him. Oh, just shut up.
Yeah, or
now there's guys scaling the building.
Yeah, it's extraordinary that they are so obtuse about what's really happening in the country and what will happen if Hillary is elected. Widespread civil disobedience, and I think the government will not be able to function. She'll never be able to govern.
This is a woman with Soros pushing killing cops and overthrowing government. Don't they already get that the NSA and stuff is already doing the leaks? This is just a warning. This is just an opening salvo.
No, and this whole narrative that the Russians and Putin are in bed with Trump, or more precisely, Trump is in bed with the Russians, they're accusing him of treason. Who are the conspiracy theorists? There's a conspiracy theory that Donald Trump, a loyal American who's never met Vladimir Putin in his life, or Paul Manafort, his former campaign chairman, who Putin despises because Manafort pushed the Ukraine into the European Union, which he opposed, that they are somehow traitors to their own country, working for Russia? Nonsense. There's a conspiracy theory for you.
All I got to say is, isn't Hillary rotting and falling apart in front of us and shaking and addled, emblematic of the rotting power structure and what it's trying right now, that they would have the arrogance to try to run a reanimated corpse, Bernie, you know, Sanders, had the election stolen from him. They are so arrogant.
No, say anything you want about Bernie. I think he really believes what he's talking about. He's really a progressive. I think he's a sincere guy. I don't think he's a crook. But the Clintons are not liberals or progressives. They're crony capitalists who march to the tune of George Soros.
Paul Watson, I'm going to take a few phone calls here at the end of this transmission. Other points you want to add, then I'm going right to the calls.
Yeah, a couple more things, Alex. WikiLeaks put out a tweet today. Bombshell set to hit Clinton campaign as FBI recovers 15,000 deleted emails. So we've got that coming down the pipeline. Of course, WikiLeaks has been releasing some Hillary's health stuff recently, the cracked head inquiry to the NFL chief, but also this thing that we reported on, which is massive, which is not getting enough attention. She was interested in decision fatigue. Now, a side effect of decision fatigue is getting angry at colleagues. This is another branch to this Hillary's health controversy, Hillary's temper tantrums. The New York Post reported back in October that her staffers were literally falling apart in tears about her rages, her endless rage. We've had Secret Service agents say the same thing. Now you've got Vince Foster. Researchers go to the National Archives, they go back a second time and find that these documents relating to Hillary Clinton's link to Vince Foster's suicide have mysteriously gone missing.
Oh.
Now, of course, whether you believe he was killed or committed suicide, we know his death was preceded by Hillary Clinton humiliating him in front of his colleagues, having one of these rage fits.
Look, I'll just say this.
And we know, because she says it in her own book, in essence, she ordered the body moved. I don't know whether he committed suicide or whether he killed himself, but here's what I do know. His body is found 30 yards down a muddy trail. It has rained only 2 hours previously, but there is no mud or even dirt on his shoes.
He was carried in a carpet, a rolled-up carpet. Look, I don't just say this as a self-fulfilling prophecy or as wishful thinking. My gut tells me if they try to steal it and install her, she's going to die in office very early. They're done. I mean, I just sense and smell failure on these people.
That explains the hysteria. That explains the personal attacks. That explains the name calling and the vituperous nature of the attacks on any Clinton critic. The media has dropped all pretense of objectivity. They're the running dog lackeys for the New World Order, and they're letting it show. They're in deep trouble, and they know it.
All right, I apologize to the callers. I've been a horrible person. Let's give each person a minute or so. Chris in Virginia, that owl killer. You're on the air. Go ahead and tell me what I've done wrong.
Yeah, so I'm in Virginia, and I'm trying to rally black Americans, especially convicted felons, around Donald Trump and around InfoWars. But the problem I'm finding out is that every time a black male dies and he has a criminal record, he's considered a thug. I'm just wondering what your thoughts on that is.
Well, I would say that I was kind of a thug when I was about 15 years old. I mean, I think a thug is just somebody that's kind of mean and ready to get in a fight. I think in the modern parlance, it's better to be a thug than one of these ninnies that just plays video games all day. So I think there is a problem, though, with thug culture that's been directed as a weapon on black people, and I think it should be absolutely rejected. That's why I fight to try to stop the targeting of black people for abortions, 52% of which never get out of the womb. Because here's the deal. I'm not going to put my soul on the line supporting killing babies. So, but I'm not going to do some virtue signaling here. Quite frankly, I'm threatened by some of the thug culture, whether it be white trash folks or, you know, thugs or whatever, black thugs, you name it. I mean, I'm threatened by thug culture. That's why I'm trying to keep people out of thug culture. What do you say to that?
Yeah, I definitely understand where you're coming from. And another point, same question I asked Dakari Jackson was, you know, how can we get more blacks around the liberty movement when we're looked at as society as a whole as minorities, you know?
Well, I mean, I think there's a distortion because even though blacks on average are involved in more violent crime, that still is crime statistically overall is small. It's media distortion. All I'm saying is if you're a leader, no matter what color you are, stand up against the New World Order and people will follow. I appreciate your call. Let's take a real quick another one here. Owl Killer, you're on the air with Roger Stone, Paul Watson. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Last time we spoke, we had a very good conversation. I just want to say that I think I have something that can steal the election for Donald Trump. He went after the people that are leading us into war, saying that he doesn't want to take advice from them anymore, and where he said that I listened to General Michael T. Flynn. He's got to harp on that we came, we saw he died with Gaddafi. He's got to harp on how they're trying
I agree. It should be raised that there was a failed state, that she backed al-Qaeda, that General Flynn has exposed that. I agree. That's a big plus for Trump that that Flynn's his main advisor on the military. Flynn is the best.
Well, and I think an examination of what happened in Libya is absolutely crucial. Hillary Clinton runs as an advocate for women, yet she is the one who fomented the toppling of Gaddafi. Now, Gaddafi wasn't a great guy, but he was sharing all of his intelligence on al-Qaeda and ISIS with
us. He'd come into the West for 8 years, he'd invested all his money, and he was an angel compared to them, and we stabbed him in the back.
And he renounced his nuclear ambitions. So what is the plight of women in
Libya
today?
That tells people, if you work with us and stop being a radical, we're going to stab you in the back.
So what is the plight of women today in Libya? Under Gaddafi, women could own property. They could travel without the approval of their husband. They could go to college. They could have as much education as they wished. They could travel without the permission of their husband. And if a woman were raped, the rapist would be prosecuted. Today, none of those things are possible.
That's backwards.
And if a woman is raped, she shall be stoned to death. This is what Hillary Clinton has brought the women of Libya, the so-called advocate
Amazing.
For women.
Al Killer, I'm out of time. I apologize to John and Anthony. If you call me back tomorrow, I promise you'll go to the head of the line. In fact, Harmon, give them all free Hillary for Prison shirts or Bill Clinton rape shirts available at InfoWarsStore.com for holding and us not getting to them. And please support the broadcast, the Natural Defense, Living Defense Special, 20% off, ends today, free shipping on orders $50 or more. And, of course, we have auto ship. 10% off additional on top of that. We signed up for that. Paul Watson, we got 60 seconds. Take us out.
I'll just finish on saying that there's a new email that's just come out, WikiLeaks, where Hillary Clinton is talking about Bill, her husband, being, quote, very interested in meeting with Vladimir Putin. So we're taught that Trump is the big Russophile, and it's Bill begging for private meetings.
Put that article out. Hillary, Bill begged to meet with Putin. WikiLeaks.
That's the article.
What else do we have, Lord Watson?
Again, Hillary Clinton's policies have led to the deaths and displacement of millions of Muslims. She's the biggest threat to Muslims, and that should be part of the narrative. It isn't. That's what Trump needs to push.
That's right. All right, folks. We got Trump coverage tonight, live, 7 o'clock Central, InfoWars.com. He's here in the ATX. Thanks, Roger Stone.
Great to be here.
Visit GCNLive.com.
StoneColdTruth.com.